bullshit.
TNA.
For those of you wondering, no, they cannot produce a third straight good show.
I'm done, guys.
Yeah. You know, I've seen worse shows.
Sure.
This had some dumb shit in it.
Oh, yes, it did. Oh, most of it. But, yeah. Yeah. It was devoid of good stuff either. There was good stuff on the show. But you're left with such a bad taste from the bad stuff.
First, AJ and Kieran came out for a speech. That's what I need. He cut a serious promo. Angle had crossed the line, challenged him to a match. Instead, Team 3D came out, got into a big argument about whether AJ was sleeping with Karen. I'm trying to figure out why Team 3D is offended that she might be sleeping around when the whole point of the show was them setting Angle up on blind dates. I guess they're just heels. I don't know. Hypocrites.
Because they're in TNA and therefore they hate women.
I see. So, AJ was fine with Bubba calling Karen a bitch, but not a whore.
No.
A man has standards. And so he snaps.
Or, for that matter, a soap opera bimbo.
Sure.
None of this angered him, but when Bubba said whore, them's fighting words.
Yeah. Ran wild on both guys, they overwhelmed him, and Rhino then made the save. And when I say finally made the save, they beat on AJ for like 3 minutes before this guy ran in. And I was like, great friend, where the fuck were you?
They beat on him so long.
Is there a labyrinth backstage that you have to go through to get to the curtain?
What a skit that would be.
Yeah.
We're going to the labyrinth to fight Rhino.
Sure.
Bring a ball of yarn so you know how to find your way back. But anyway, yes, Team 3D beat up AJ, and they beat him up, and they beat him up. Then he made his own comeback.
Of course.
And then they cut him off and beat him up again.
Of course.
This went on forever and ever and ever.
And then his friend came out.
And then finally Rhino showed up.
Maybe Rhino's like, oh, he's making a comeback. I'll let him. No,
yeah.
Got cut off. Maybe I'll wait to see if he did. No. All right, I'll run it now.
Someone just set
Jesus
up a bomb outside, actually, yes.
I don't know if it was that or the thunder last night that scared the shit out of me. So, anyway, they basically, it ended up with Rhino challenging 3D and Angle to a match with himself, Christian, and AJ at the pay-per-view. He wanted a TLC match. Crowd chanted TLC, but he said, no, in TNA we call it Full Metal Mayhem. Thanks for the confusion. And then they announced that the fans would pick the stipulations, but did not specify how. So apparently text messaging, I would guess. But Devon cut another pretty good promo, accepted for his team, said the blood would be on the hands of the fans, and that was that.
This is not good. It was long. It was boring. But I did not feel terribly insulted by it, and everything made sense. You had the heels beating up the good guy, his friend saving, then they issued a challenge. Everything here made sense, and I was okay with this.
We had them announcing Raisha versus Taylor, where if Taylor won, she'd get a shot at the women's title plus the $25,000 if she won. And then we got the first of three Angle on a Blind Date skits. These were awful. TNA every now and then hits on some comedy. This was not it.
No.
This first date, he said he was going to have one date at a gym, one date at lunch, and a third date at a romantic dinner. Why you would take the first two dates, I have no idea. So he went to the gym, and of course there was a fit girl climbing the little mountain dealie bob there. And then, of course, the real girl was just a big fat woman. That's it. That was the comedy.
Yes.
There's no more to add to this.
No.
There was a big fat girl, and then they cut away.
That is the punchline.
Ha 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 ha!
She was fat.
This was shit.
And the punchlines would get significantly worse.
So then we had promos from fans. Fans, I say! Hyping up the fans' revenge strap match. And Mike Tenay actually said that apparently I, Bryan Alvarez, was going to be there. He looked right at me and said, you will be there! And I thought, I would love to! I would love to be at TNA with a strap, strapping the shit out of people. And then they had a segment that was so horrendously bad. I'm just trying to think about how to start this. Basically, they said they were going to go to LAX via satellite. Satellite was apparently backstage at the Impact Zone.
It's not like maybe there's a mirror on the ceiling.
Everything around them was the same stuff that's backstage at every TNA show. They didn't even try and make it different. And what we had was Hector Guerrero, and behind him was LAX and Salinas. And Hector Guerrero was trying to channel Eddie. Meanwhile, the other Mexicans were all just babbling incoherently. So we had four people all making noise at the same time. Maybe it's just me. Maybe I just haven't followed enough of the history of wrestling, but I don't remember Hector Guerrero being renowned as like a great promo guy. I don't remember people saying, wow, Hector Guerrero sure lit that promotion on fire with his crazed promos.
Not much of the ring, but boy, you put a stick in his hands.
Yeah. But no, he's the promo guy for this team. They got homicide there, but let's give the mic to Hector. So anyway, all these guys are ranting and raving and screaming and carrying on, and suddenly out come James Storm and Robert Roode to the ring, and they claim that they had interrupted the satellite feed. Initially, I thought, thank God. I was wrong.
Oh, you're wrong.
We went from four people talking all over themselves to seven. We had Hector, LAX, Salinas, Storm, Roode, and Jackie all talking at the same time. This is the worst TV of the year. There's actually a drop, I think, somewhere of everybody talking over each other on Observer Live. This was worse.
Because there were seven.
There were seven people doing this at the same time. So it gets better. Roode and Harris faced the Motor City Machine Guns. Good guys ran wild, and it was all great, and the heels cut off Saban, some fun double teams, and a bunch of state-of-the-art spots, and then some 1985 spots with forward rolls through the legs and everything. That's why these guys are so great. They mix it up. And anyway, it ended up with Shelley and Storm in the ring, and Jackie tried to spit beer into Shelley's face, but he ducked, and she spit beer into Storm's face, and Shelley got the pin. Now, when this match began, and they announced that it was a preview match for the pay-per-view, because, of course, James Storm and Robert Roode are challenging LAX for the tag team titles, I thought, you know, it must suck to be the Machine Guns and be so goddamn great and just always be doing jobs to the big stars, I guess as you would call them. Again, I was wrong. The number one contender for the tag team titles, beaten. Which, of course, begs the question, why aren't the Machine Guns getting the championship match now?
Well, I don't know.
I guess it's TNA.
They're already booked for the X Cup is the answer.
Because fucking TNA is the answer.
Yeah, prior commitment.
So anyway, they beat them, beat the number one contenders, and then the heels went nuts and started whipping everybody, including Don West.
That was so awesome. I don't think he was prepared for it. He began to scream and cry into the microphone, and I laughed and howled, and I forgave them for everything.
That was awesome. So, yeah, they beat them up. And then Cornette came out and said if they didn't stop, they'd be fired. And he was so mad at the heels that he announced that the two biggest, meanest guys backstage were going to wrestle Storm and Roode later. So there you go.
The only thing, other thing I have to mention here is that somewhere in this mess, the team of James Storm and Robert Roode was giving it a name.
They were.
And it is the best name any tag team has ever had. They collectively are known as Beer Money.
Beer Money.
Here they are, Beer Money.
Beer Money.
And it's pretty self-explanatory, but they would explain it in greater detail later.
It got better later.
Oh my God, it got better.
Beer Money was awesome, don't get me wrong, but, we'll really talk about Beer Money in a while.
As usual with the show, the wrestling was awesome. Everything around them sucked.
Yeah. Angle met with somebody for his second date. We never saw this person's face, so he knew it was trouble. And he's talking and this and that, and then JB goes, got chest hair and an Adam's apple. And Angle's like, a man? And then he beat up on the man. That was the end, everybody.
That was it, yes, correct.
That was a joke.
Yes.
You should all be laughing right now. Ha, 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 it was a man. Ha, ha, ha. Retarded. So.
And still better than what we get to come later.
That led to Moose and Roxy in a hardcore match.
Yeah, I have a question about Moose here.
Why is she booked?
Well, not even that.
Actually, I'll tell you why, because the quarter last week was the highest in ever.
Well, that would explain why. But for a woman whose gimmick is that she hates bimbos, whose theme song begins with her growling, "I hate bimbos." Why is she always fighting in bimbo knockout brawls?
Because she's trying to knock out bimbos.
I thought it would make her a bimbo then.
No, she's trying to knock out bimbos.
I see.
It's a bimbo knockout brawl. She's in there to knock out bimbos.
So if she gets knocked out, does that mean she is the bimbo?
If you hate bimbos, and I put you in a bimbo knockout match, it would suggest you're going to go beat up some bimbos.
Mm.
Not that you're a bimbo. Although she's a bimbo, because they were just hitting each other in the head with shit over and over.
This is a Monday Night Raw hardcore match from 1999.
With women.
With chicks hitting each other in the head. Not my thing. But
I always wonder what compels people to want that to be their style. I want to be a hardcore wrestler. I want that to be my gimmick. What compels people?
Well,
explain this to me.
You're not...
I'd like to not walk well later.
Yeah.
I'd like to have brain injuries in a few years.
Constant headaches.
Why?
Neck trauma. That's my kind of thing.
They hit each other with a bunch of shit, and then Roxy got pinned and busted open, so she was bleeding everywhere. Thumbs down segment.
And, by the way, her hair should be much longer than it is now.
She keeps shaving it.
That's so bad.
It's not going to grow back.
There was one great, great, great moment in this match where Moose threw Roxy into the stairs, then grabbed the shopping cart and went to ram it into her. And the wheel of the cart caught the lip of the mat and came to a sudden stop. But Moose kept going and went into the cart shin first. And the match stopped. And she grabbed her shin and went, ow. That was fantastic.
Cornette met with Nash about putting Rude and Storm in their place, and he said, "I'm sure there could be a financial bonus in it for you." So, of course, the way to Nash's heart is through his wallet. So he said, "Who's my partner?" And Cornette said, "Joe." And Nash was like, "He knows about this?" And Cornette said, "Not yet." And Nash said, "Good luck telling him." And Cornette said, "So you don't have a problem with this?" Meaning... he was just trying to stir shit.
Yeah.
What an asshole.
That's his goal, is to pick a fight here between Nash and Joe. I also just love that he said he wanted the two biggest, surliest, scariest guys. They went to Kevin Nash, the guy whose legs don't work right.
Well, he's tall.
He's tall and big.
So then he met with Joe after commercial, and he was trying to sell this idea to him. Did a very poor job. He did a far worse job than I did trying to sell the Kindle. He basically said, because of Nash, you're all paranoid now.
Yeah.
That's a positive.
I swear to God, that's his exact words. Nash has been good for you because now you're paranoid. And even Joe looked like, what the fuck?
So Joe yelled and screamed and told him to fuck off. And so Cornette finally said, listen, me management, you wrestler, shut the fuck up, you're doing the match. Okay.
Okay. That led to a Joe Nash feud recap, which I can't tell you how quickly we skipped.
Oh, yeah.
This is the dumbest feud ever.
So it's time for Angle's third date. And every 10 minutes, this woman ran off. So Angle determined, well, she must be bulimic. So she came back, and he accused her of such, and she said, no, I have serious medical issues. It's called spastic colon. Ha 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 ha!
And again, that was the punchline.
That's the punchline.
Kurt thought this was funny.
Sure.
Kurt and Borash, oh, they laughed their asses off.
Yeah. At least somebody did. Who wrote this shit? Like,
yes.
Somebody wrote this and
yes.
Thought, boy, this is going to be funny in execution. Well, it was not. So, Kurt got mad and said he was going to go beat up Bubba.
Yes, you recall he was set up on these dates by Brother Ray from Team 3D.
Brother Ray Dudley. So then we had Alex Kozlov versus Ray Bucanero. They had about a 1 minute match or so. A bunch of lucha spots.
It was really fun while it lasted.
And then Bucanero dropped him right on his fucking neck. I don't know if this was supposed to be the finish. I don't think Kozlov was hurt bad. But he did not look happy after that. And they immediately went to the finish. And that was the end.
That is his finisher. I remember back in the day when I did lucha recaps, he did that every match. And I always screamed when I saw it. It's the scariest move in the world. I call it the wheelbarrow driver, because I don't know any better way to describe it. But yes, he holds you in wheelbarrow position and then drops you on the back of your neck. Bad times.
Yeah, that's no fun. All right, where were we? Where were we?
Kurt Angle hates Ray.
Borash alerted Angle that Bubba had signed him to the six-man, and he was very mad, so he came out and cut a promo, and Ray came out and said, listen, we're all friends here, let's talk about this. First he said, let's go backstage to talk about it. Then he just kept talking. So, I don't know. But he said, here's the problem with this blind date. Or no, first he explained the match. He goes, listen, Christian went through a glass table. He'll never be back in time for the pay-per-view. We have the numbers advantage. And I thought, wow, somebody here gets it. That's good. So Angle was pissed off about the blind dates, and Bubba said, the problem was I couldn't find my little black book, and we had to use Devon's. And you know the weird shit he's into. And this was not enough for Kurt. So Bubba said, well, listen, I found a great rat for you. I was going to keep her for myself, but I'm going to give her to you.
Because afterwards, I was going to use her myself.
Yes. She's more than 10. She's an 11, he said. And he brought out a Sandy, a hot blonde model type. And Kurt asked her, what can you offer me, a champion? And she said she liked to have fun and was loyal. At which point Angle burst into a tirade about how she was not loyal. She's a liar. All women are liars. They're all cheaters, and they're all full of shit. Just like my wife, Karen, he said. She said if she had the chance to sleep with another man in his bed, she'd do it. So screw you! I love this company.
Who do you know?
It just baffles me.
I can only imagine if we showed this scene to a dozen psychologists, the party they would have.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So she finally goes, screw you! And he said, I'm sorry, I lose my temper sometimes. I would never touch a woman, but I know some people that would. And so he called out the beautiful women, who proceeded to put a bag on her head. At which point Bubba's like, hey, the bag! And there were fans in the front row going, bag, bag, bag! They're supposed to be heels.
Right.
The bag's over. So, of course, a bunch of people ran out. We had AJ, ODB, Gail Kim. They all cleared the ring. And I'm dying, dying to see Velvet Sky against Karen Angle. Dream match.
Yes. Karen was the first one out, and she took care of Angelina. And then she had a stare down with Velvet Sky. And I just began to giggle and chortle at the thought of that.
Dream match. We had JB meeting with Booker T in his beautiful dressing room backstage. And it was awesome.
That's his gimmick now.
He's just awesome.
He has a nice crib, and he's awesome, yes.
If Booker T could play blues guitar, that fucking guy would be a legend.
Or harmonica.
A legend! No, the blues guitar. He could be the next Lightning Hopkins. I'm telling you right now. And he's from Houston, for Christ's sake.
True.
So anyway, this was awesome. Then we got another Matt Morgan deal with Cornette talking about the days in Ohio Valley, and he got a subtle dig in on WWE by saying, anybody who didn't see talent in Matt Morgan had to be blind. Which would, in fact, be WWE.
Yes, they discussed how they called him up. They took this giant athletic guy, called him up too early, gave him a stupid stuttering gimmick, and then fired him when he didn't get over.
Yeah.
All of this is true.
Yeah.
All of this is true.
We had Milano Collection AT against the Curry Man. Fun little match. Curry is apparently part of Team TNA, even though he's supposedly Japanese. But he tried a high cross, and that was not the finish, which saddened me. And Milano finally hit a low blow behind the ref's back, hit a half-twisting moonsault for the pin, and
he killed Curry Man.
Someone needs to show this to Matt Farmer. You think you got it bad, buddy. Look at poor Curry Man.
Indeed. You are at least significantly smaller than Matt Farmer.
That's true.
Curry
that's
Man
true.
And Milano were approximately the same size.
Poor Curry Man. He just gets jobbed left and right. He got jobbed
He's
in
the most
other,
over... Yes.
Was the other whatever this is called, X Cup thingamajigger. He just jobs left and right. But this is fun. This was fun, except the finish looked like it sucked. And then we had Lauren backstage with Beer Money! Vinny, go ahead.
Well, you see, Robert Roode was cutting a promo. It was generic. It was monotone. It was uneventful. In the background, we could see James Storm. He had a plan. And he was making movements and looking around. He wanted to make sure Robert Roode wasn't watching him as he put a t-shirt on. He put the t-shirt on with his back to the camera. Didn't cover the front of the shirt with his cowboy hat, and he turned around. Apparently, Robert Roode said, what are you doing? And Storm took his cowboy hat away to reveal that his shirt said, Beer Money on it!
Yeah.
In small letters, by the way.
With an arrow pointing down that said, place tag belts here.
Yes. That's their shirt. And Root said, so you paid for these? And Storm said, no, I made them. And Root said, wow, I never would have guessed. But he had a shirt, too, and he put it on. And then James Storm got awesome.
He cut a promo.
Oh, he cut a promo. A promo I cannot do justice to, but he talked about how they showed the machine guns how tough they were, and now they were going to show at the pay-per-view, they were going to show LAX how tough they were, and if necessary, they were going to show the fans how tough they were, and they were sorry about everyone's damn luck, and this guy rules.
Yes.
Beer Money's a fantastic team.
Yes.
They have a great name. They're my favorite act in wrestling right now, as of just because of this one show.
No, last week was even better. Beer Money's awesome.
Last week, though, they did not have the name Beer Money.
No, they didn't, but...
Beer Money!
This is the best team around.
He pointed out, the reason they beat the Machine Guns, he said, was because they interrupted a beer run.
Sure.
I love this man!
Awesome. So, then we had Raisha Saeed versus Taylor. They said that Taylor had a wrestling background, which was quite the revelation.
Is that what that means?
As she could wrestle, had gear and boots. But thanks for telling us, Tanae. And then, of course, noted that Raisha had trained in the Orient with Awesome Kong.
It's 2008. No one says the Orient anymore except Mike Tanae.
Can he say Asia Minor or something?
It's just so archaic.
The Orient.
He should have said the East.
The East. So Taylor made a big comeback, and everything was great. And then we had a dumb finish. Taylor had the win, but Kong pulled the ref out of the ring. Taylor then got the win with the German.
Immediately.
There's nothing like a ref bump for literally absolutely no fucking reason.
Well, I could see the reason that they were trying to have Kong screw out of the win and fail, but it came off so poorly because the win came literally 8 seconds later.
Yeah. This was retarded. So, anyway, next week she gets Kong with the title and $25,000 on the line.
At the pay-per-view, you say?
No.
Next week?
On free TV.
Well, that's odd.
Really? Is this really odd in TNA?
Everything up to this point has been so fine, and now they're doing it on TV.
Dumbasses. It gets better. Joe and Nash against Beer Money. So, God bless TNA. But they have pyro for Beer Money. And if you remember in WWE, when Goldberg used to come out with sparklers, they may have hired Dwayne Gill to stand back there with sparklers, because this is the saddest pyro I've ever seen, and it's supposed to be legit real pyro for these guys.
I like to think
I will have better fireworks tomorrow.
I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt and assume that James Storm, in addition to making the t-shirts, actually made this pyro.
He had to have. This is like those little pinwheel sparklers. That's what these were.
No, those at least spin.
These
are shot out.
This was so lame. So then they had a match, and of course you know the deal. Joe and Angle had their issues. Nash could barely get in and out of the ring. And,
Okay. Joe's the TNA champion, everyone. But he's also the only one who can actually wrestle, so of course they got the heat on him.
Yeah.
During the commercial, because it's TNA.
Yeah.
So he came back, and I believe Beer Money's entire offense in this match consisted of the chin lock Robert Roode had on Joe.
Yeah.
So Joe finally cut him off and waited to make the hot tag and saw Nash and sneered and flipped him off.
Yeah.
Because he's a dick.
Because he's a fucking stupid babyface.
He's a stupid babyface.
Yeah.
Then he got beat up again. So Nash said, fuck it, and came in and cleaned house.
Yes, he did.
So while the two men could beat up Joe, they were no match for Kevin Nash, destroyer of worlds.
Yes.
So he destroyed them all and then ran wild, and he and I believe Storm disappeared.
Yep. And Joe pinned Roode clean with the muscle buster.
Although not before. Roode went for the payback, his finisher, which is the cradle suplex. But he couldn't do it. Why? Because Joe's fat, everyone.
Fat and a stupid baby face.
Joe's a big, fat, stupid baby face.
This was sad. And
but Nash, that also, guy's a tough fucker.
What also was sad, Joe pinned Roode clean with the muscle buster. They lost twice on the same show! The number one contenders!
Yes.
How are they the number one contenders?
Well, because...
By my calculations, they are at least the number three contenders right now. This company is so stupid.
Yes.
I can't even... So anyway.
So yeah, the streak's
over. It gets
over.
Better. It gets better. So after the number one contenders lose twice on one show, and they portray as Joe as being too fat and dumb, they... although he did win. I got to give him that. But anyway, the lights went out. Sting's music played. I don't even know why.
No, Sting's music played.
And he appeared in the rafters.
They said, where is he? He's not on the ramp. He's not on the ring. He's on the crowd. He's in the sky. And looked for the Raptors. the rafters, and there was Sting, and he was there.
How can people not realize, except for Mark Henry apparently, that it's 2008? Sting was in the rafters in 1997, 11 years ago.
So what you're suggesting is that Mark Henry should book TNA.
This would be like in 1998 when, actually this happened, when 1998 when WCW was the number one promotion in the world, they kept referencing angles from 1985.
It did in fact bill have Hogan Warrior from 89, I think, something like that.
91. Still.
Too old.
11 years. This was 11 years ago. And they still think it's relevant today. Baffles me. I can take no more, kids. I've ranted and raved.
This is my retarded
fourth show in 24 hours.
That sucks.
I don't want to do any more talking.
Okay.
So.
To the back!
All right, Impact was awful.
Thanks, kids.
Get out of the way at first. Boy, what a wretched show. It wasn't, you know, how can I say this? When I watched the show, when I was writing about everything, I was writing about how awful it was. But actually, just if I would have watched the show and not thought about it so much, it would have been a fine show. It would have been fine. I know that reading it back, I'm probably going to think it's awful again. But I'm not sure. Because whenever we read back the Impact review, sometimes it's better or worse than we remembered. But I really think that just, I think if we did a poll, like on the, in fact, we'll do a poll tomorrow. What did you think of last night's Impact? I think most people will say fair. I think that's what most people will vote on this poll. However, personally, I thought it was really bad. When you dissect it, this was a bad show.
I suspect you think it's bad now. When we go back over it, you'll think, holy crap, it was much worse than we thought.
I'd like if somebody croaked and you dissected them and found that they had all sorts of diseases. You know what I mean? It'd be like, well, you know, I thought they just died of old age. And then you actually cut them open and look at everything, and you're like, wow, what a train wreck that is. That's what this show is.
It died?
Yeah! What a death this show died. And what a death the pay-per-view is going to die, because I can't imagine anybody buying it. Let me tell you something about this pay-per-view. This is going to be a good pay-per-view as far as the actual wrestling. This will be a good pay-per-view. If you, like, look at all the matches on this show, it's a good pay-per-view. However, as usual, this fucking show didn't do a thing to compel you to buy this show.
No.
Nobody is buying this show.
You know what the most compelling promotional bit on this show was? The Hellboy 2 commercial. I can't wait for Hellboy 2.
Anyway, everybody, the big thing on this pay-per-view is supposed to be like this big X-Division deal. There's a Tornado Cibernetico with the X-Division guys, and there's a Ultimate X match. That's going to fucking be great. Now, from watching this show, what do we know about this X-Cup? I don't know jack shit.
A bunch of small dudes running around with their points involved.
Somebody on the board said, wasn't there supposed to be a round three?
Now, how do you know this, Brian?
I said I'd be on the board.
Okay, fine.
Somebody on the board said, isn't there supposed to be a round three? And that's a great question. I have no idea what's going on. I have no idea what's going on. It is, as usual, a complete and total clusterfuck. And this World X Cup, as always, so much potential. Look at the fucking guys they got in there. Ultimo Guerrero,
absolutely.
Rey Bucanero. God, the list goes on and on. And what did we get out of it? Some wacky show, a series of wacky shows where I really...
There are just matches going on.
Just matches.
I gave up a long time ago on the point
nothing.
Thing. Yes.
So no one's buying it for that, which is sad because it's going to be good. Show opened in the parking lot, and I already hated it.
They announced the title of the show was First, they announced LAX would fight Beer Money in a Victory Road drive-by. And I thought, A, why are they fighting already the pay-per-views in 2 days? B, what is the Victory Road drive-by? Then that title went up on the screen, Victory Road drive-by. They cut to the parking lot where there was a circle of cars. There was Homicide, a ref for Christ knows what reason, and Robert Roode in his wrestling gear.
Yeah.
For a street fight.
Yeah. And, of course, it had a run-in, which Don West tried to explain should not be allowed in the street fight.
He actually said, there are no rules, and then when there was a run-in, he said, they didn't follow the rules.
Yes. They didn't follow the no rules rules. Or they made, I don't know what he was talking about. So James Storm ran in and double-teamed him. No friends of Homicide, so what a hoodlum he turned out to be. No backup in a street fight. So then they handcuffed him and brought him into the arena, and Hernandez finally made the save. And this was one of those bullshit angles that I hate so passionately that I just want to throw something through my TV. You've got a babyface being beaten. A babyface runs in to make the save. He runs wild, but then the heels cut him off. And then he makes his own comeback and beats him up again.
Mm-hmm.
And the question is, why'd you have to cut him off? Just let the goddamn guy make his big comeback. Why did the heels have to cut him off again? God, I hate that. So then after the heels bailed, Sting's music played and he was shown in the rafters. Here in 2008, everybody. I hate this program.
This went on forever. You don't have to pay to see them wrestle because you saw them wrestle for free here. It was Beer Money versus LAX. And yes.
It wasn't. It was Robert Roode versus Homicide.
Did James Storm get involved?
Yeah, but he was cheating.
Did Hernandez get involved?
After it was over.
I saw LAX fight Beer Money. I don't need to see them wrestle now. And I saw whippings. And I saw the baby faces get their revenge. I saw everything I would want to see. Everything I was supposed to pay to see, I saw for free here in the first segment.
Yes.
Bad.
We had Yoshino against Doug Williams, which was a fun little match, although it pissed me off. I'll tell you why. Last week, they edited all the matches down to about 2 minutes. This week, they aired the entire match and couldn't even be bothered to edit out a botched spot.
Yeah.
Fucking idiots.
They're fucktards. That's what they do.
One botched spot, there was a wacky, goofy head scissors that looked horrible, and they couldn't edit it out. So then Doug hit all sorts of moves, including a big underhook suplex off the top, and of course, Yoshino kicked out. And then the finish was the rolling reverse cradle into a German, which is always a great spot, but looked even better because Yoshino's about 105 pounds.
That helped a lot, yes.
And that ruled. So that was fun.
That was a fun match. I like Don West saying, after Yoshino hit the ropes and ran into a boot or something, and Don West said, that's the thing, he's so fast, sometimes he can't stop. Which, all they need to do then is Irish whip him, like, away from the ring. And just run up the ramp and disappear forever.
Or towards a wall.
Or towards a wall.
Can you find something sticking out of the wall, like a spike?
Sure. And the other thing I think was, can you imagine how awesome Doug Williams would be in the Vladimir Kozlov role? Just the sort of blandest guy beating the fuck out of people?
Man, it's too small.
I know that's the flaw in the plan, but it would be fun.
Angle met with the Beautiful People. He's teaming with them tonight. Seriously. It is Angle and the Beautiful People against AJ, ODB, and Gail Kim. And he basically told them to stop getting all pretty and start doing some squats. So then he left, and Angelina told Borash to spot her. So he was behind her, and she was bending over. And then she was like, my God, that better be your microphone. And since it wasn't, she told Velvet to get the bag. And Borash screamed, and I quote, no, please, not the bag! And they put the bag on his head, and he was helpless. They realize how stupid it is.
Yes.
And it's now even stupider comedy.
Yes.
This still, I laughed so hard.
Everything about it, really. Just, yes, oh no, not the bag. The bag is something to be feared and dreaded.
It is.
And all people are powerless to defend themselves. No one can withstand the brown paper bag.
That was the best segment in years right there. Then the guru was doing a yoga class, and Lauren was there. And so, I swear to God, they did another girl bends over in front of the guy comedy spot.
Yeah, the next segment.
In two straight segments. I just don't even understand how you can do stupid shit like this. Nobody thinks.
No, Brian, they don't.
Okay.
They're fucktards.
So then Petey was doing some stuff, and Black Machismo ran in and beat the shit out of Guru, until Guru hid behind the children, and they started a set Val free chant. There were also balls involved here.
There,
not in the bend over spot.
Jay Lethal threw Sanjay in front of a giant rack of exercise balls. All I could think was, hit him with an exercise ball! And he actually topped. He had a much better idea than what I had. He pulled down the entire rack, you know, the PVC pipe rack that holds up the exercise balls. He pulled this thing down on top of Sanjay. The whole thing could not have weighed more than 60 pounds.
Yeah.
And Sanjay was trapped. That brought me joy.
So, again, comedy, thus killing any real desire to see these guys fight.
Of course.
It's just a clown show.
But it entertained me.
Well, sure, it was funny. But, again, I don't know. Why do we even rant about this every week?
I try not to. I've long ago given up on what sells, what's good for business. Does it entertain me? That's all I care about.
Well, I'm going to remember this on Sunday when you have to come over for this pay-per-view, and you're bitching about
it. If it entertains me, I'll be having fun.
I'm going to say, you should be happy to see this pay-per-view. Val put balls on somebody or some bullshit. I don't even remember what happened here.
That's clear.
Then we had Lauren interviewing Taylor about the Kong match. This was horrible. She cut the most melodramatic promo you've ever heard, to the point that it was pure comedy. She was talking about it was a once-in-a-lifetime experience, even though this isn't, for a fact, her second chance. And then she said, thank you for wishing me luck, Lauren. I'm going to need it.
And she touched Lauren on the arm, and Lauren touched her back. Touching. Touching. And by the way, what an inspiring promo. Not, I'm the one who's going to beat Kong. Kong's had this coming for 2 weeks. I almost had her last time. Not, this is the night it comes true. No, she was nervous and sweaty and scared.
Yeah.
That's like a Colin Delaney promo.
We had another Morgan promo, Matt Morgan. This one, actually, the best part was when Kurt explained that sometimes you could be such a big star, they didn't need to put the belt on you.
That was just, yes. Kill the belt.
And I shake my head.
Just, you want to make sure everyone knew. But between that and the fact Kurt was in the main event of the show, it just kind of makes you go,
By the way, everybody, it's fake. Let's just throw that in everybody's face. Then we had Morgan, BG James, and Eric Young against Kip James, Petey, and Tomko in a battle of guys that actually are still under contract that they were doing something with and then just vanished.
And also, this wacky, pointless, random six-man was also Falls Count Anywhere.
Yeah, for no reason.
For no reason.
No. Brawl all over the place, in the crowd. And then I got enraged when Petey went for Canadian Destroyer and Eric swept his legs and basically did a wheelbarrow into a neck breaker, which was fucking awesome. And, of course, it wasn't a finish.
No.
He just kicked out. And then he tried to dive, and Tomko hit him with a pipe. And then Petey, who is a heel, by the way, did this pescado into a hurricane run outside on Eric for the pin. And, yeah.
You know, when this started, I saw, okay, it's a collection of random guys. They're allowed to do stuff outside the ring. It's going to come down. We just saw a Matt Morgan promo. It's going to come down to Matt Morgan being the big, scary giant, killing all three dudes and pinning them. Fine. No!
Wrong.
Petey Williams, who is also the X Division champion, he pinned Eric Young. Nothing was established here.
Well, it was established that they're fools. We had, what do we have? Oh, then Abyss ran in, which also raised many questions. Number one, why are you still wearing your outfit?
Your pajamas?
Your pajamas.
The prison garb.
Okay, you're out. Okay, change your fucking clothes. And number two, why is it so clean?
He's been wearing it now nonstop for like 3 months.
You taking it to the dry cleaners every night? What the hell are you doing? You're supposed to be a monster. And the park on the back should be pork, because he was so fat.
He's shrunk.
Thanks, everybody.
Yeah,
exactly. Pork.
Because he's fat.
Because he's fat. Well, it's true.
He's a big fat guy.
He was huge and fat. And his last name's Park.
Which is almost
pork.
Like pork.
It is. It's very similar to that word, pork.
Which is fat.
Yeah.
This is the worst show we've ever done.
Pork. All right. Where was I? Oh, then we had Awesome Kong and Taylor for the title and $25,000. Kong attacked her at the bell. Taylor fought back, all full of piss and vinegar. And then we had some stupidity, as is always the case in TNA. Raisha tripped Taylor as she was running the ropes. Of course, right in front of the referee. Referee doesn't care. So then out comes Roxy to beat up Raisha. And the ref stops her and is like, no, you can't do that. I can't watch this show and not get angry. Listen. Everyone here, I'm sure listening to this, has at least read one news article from, like, back in the day. Maybe you've seen it on a Carl Stern thing that we've posted. Maybe you've seen it somewhere in some sort of comedy deal or something. I don't know. But you read an old article about wrestling, and if you took your average sports writer from fucking 1935 and took him to a wrestling match, without question, he would make some sort of mention of the incompetence of the referees. Everybody knows this. A man who has never watched any pro wrestling in his whole life knows that the referees are incompetent in pro wrestling. Is this a secret?
No.
It isn't TNA. The refs in TNA are, like, too smart. They always catch the heels. Why?
Didn't catch Raisa.
He did! He looked right at her!
And let it go. That's incompetent right there.
It's a different kind of incompetent, though. Why can't TNA refs pretend to be dumb?
What you're telling me
is... Why can't the ref turn his back when he knows interference is coming?
So you're telling me TNA referees cannot even get incompetence right?
Yes!
I see.
If you're a referee, and you know that a spot is coming where somebody on the outside is going to trip somebody on the inside, tie your shoe.
Check
the
time.
Look the other way. Or, better yet, just be in a position where you can't see it. These fucking TNA referees are always in the perfect position to see every bit of interference. It just baffles me. Where do they get these people? I'll tell you where they get these people. In no other business, let me ask this question. How many of, like, the big Enron executives do you think got hired after that whole thing went kaput?
None.
Do you think Microsoft was begging for Enron employees or some other big energy company?
No.
No! Every fucking idiot from WCW was immediately hired by TNA. They've got the entire production crew. They've got the fucking ring announcer. They've got the referees. They picked up everybody. It's just fucking ridiculous.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. After all these fucking years, you can't look the other way? God, that pissed me off. Losing my voice here. So then Taylor made a big comeback and they did a bunch of near falls. Kong hit some moves and she kicked out. And then Taylor finally slipped behind and cradled her for the flash pin. Place went ballistic, so I got to give the whole thing a thumbs up. Although I do have to ask the question, if they immediately signed the pay-per-view rematch, why wasn't this just for the 25 grand?
Yeah.
And she could have went for the title at the pay-per-view.
That's a fine
question.
Is this
not fucking common sense?
That's a fine question.
I
mean, even then, I could still, in my head, I could kind of see myself, well, this show will be watched by more people than the pay-per-view, therefore they're trying to make her a star here. But then
she
could
have been a star winning the 25 grand!
That's true. And either way, they didn't do it, right? Because she won, she walked around like, what happened? Did I win? And then Mike Tenay said, coming up! And you plug Booker T's appearance.
Yes.
Compare this to CM Punk's Flash World title win, wherein there was a big giant celebration for a long time, for several minutes. They didn't mention anything else. The world ended, we went to break, and all we knew was that CM Punk was world champ. Then they came back, and they showed us the whole thing again.
The whole thing.
Yes.
And I think they showed us the entire thing about three more times on the show.
Indeed. Here, Taylor won. It led to them plugging Booker T's appearance and was never mentioned again.
These people are fools.
Do you now agree this show is worse than you remember?
Yes.
Okay.
Team TNA, it was a good title change at least. The people went crazy for it. But everything else about it was typical idiotic TNA. So then Team TNA was backstage. Kaz cut a promo about how they were the heart and soul of TNA. They were going to be damned if they let an outside team humiliate them. Said it wasn't about losing or winning, it was about pride. And then they immediately said that if they won, they were out.
I don't know.
Who writes this?
I don't know.
I know, actually. Vince Russo.
He's an idiot.
He is a fool. Ultimo Guerrero beat... actually, Kaz beat Ultimo Guerrero.
And that's a crime.
They actually had a great match. The best part of this match was Alex Shelley. Alex Shelley's on the ramp, and he's just bigger than he's ever been. He was just gigantic. And first off, they had all of Team TNA on the ramp acting like they were watching.
It always great.
They couldn't just watch. They'd act like they were watching.
Ooh, oh no.
Yeah. So Alex Shelley... just for no reason, takes his shirt off. It's like Petey Williams or something like that, but he's a big baby face.
He was so concerned about his teammates' fate that he couldn't keep his clothing on.
Well, I thought the heat was on or something. So I laughed my ass off about that, but Kaz botched a dive, and...
It was actually a great botch, because he tried to do a springboard and slipped and fell on his face and immediately grabbed his knee.
Yeah.
Like his knee buckled on the ropes, and it was sold it for like a minute afterwards. So it was a fine botch. And Guerrero pounced on him and tried to get a pin out of it. So, you know, it didn't look like a you fucked up thing. It looked like, oh, no, he's hurt. That being said, Ultimo Guerrero is fucking awesome.
He is?
He was hitting these giant, scary reverse superplexes and just these huge power moves. And Kaz went for a top rope Rana, and Guerrero just stopped in mid-move, Horked him back up and hit a super power bomb, and I thought, you are the god of wrestling right now. Then he got pinned.
Let me tell you what was so stupid about this. I liked the match for the most part, but we had Ultimo Guerrero hitting a delayed front superplex, a reverse superplex, and a power bomb off the top rope, none of which were the finish, and then Kaz just won with a downward spiral. I don't know.
There were
wrestling
some,
has passed me by.
There were some wrong things here.
Wrestling has passed me by. So then we had AJ, Gale, and ODB cutting a promo. AJ went first, and he was talking about, it's not about me and Angle tonight. It's about the girls. These girls have done so much for this business. Gale and ODB, mind you, done so much for this business, and I have more respect for you than you'll ever know. And then Gale starts ranting and raving about how they paved the way for chicks, and the beautiful people were just taking advantage of it. Her delivery was something else. And then the best promo of all was actually ODB, who was like Ric Flair compared to the other two, where she said she was going to give the beautiful people a facial they would never forget. So this is not the show for children, everybody.
Yeah, this was... I don't know. I have long said that I don't know why ODB is popular. After watching this promo, I kind of get it, because the other two were just lumps. Just complete wooden lumps. She at least was very wacky.
Yes.
Her wackiness, when compared to the... contrasted with the plain white paper that was Gale and AJ, her wackiness stood out and was fun.
Then it gets better. Kurt met with his team, tanning and doing their nails, and he said these bitches were just like his wife. They only cared about their boobs. And then he screamed to Angelina, and I quote, "Screw your boobs!" And I was like, okay! I would much prefer that over this bullshit.
I can't. You know, I was going to say something about how the irony is that Kurt once was tanning backstage. Now he's then tanning backstage, but I can't.
That's what happened.
It did happen, but it's so low rent compared to your glee and the idea of Kurt tits fucking Angelina Jolie here on Impact.
Angelina Jolie.
Or
now that'd be a show.
Whoever this woman was.
So then Booker came out. I'm just trying to make Impact better.
You did. You succeeded.
So then Booker came out and called out Joe for
a tit fucking.
May as well have. I mean, you made fun of his physique.
I apologize to everyone listening here. You're paying for a quality show and we failed.
I can't.
We have failed you.
I didn't even say it as lewdly as you just did, Vinny.
No.
Granny's listening to this right now.
Not anymore.
She's appalled.
She's just turned it off and will probably, now she really will punch me.
So Booker came out and he's the most dapper man around, and he said he was gonna beat up Joe. And then Joe said, "No, I'm going to beat up you." And it actually led to Booker saying, "Who have you beat?" And before Joe can answer, he says, "Well, let me tell you who I beat. Rick Martel."
And Mike Tenay pointed out, he's a former world champion. And I thought, Jesus Christ, that was 25 years ago.
Steve Austin.
Okay.
And Chris Jericho. Those were his three names.
He's beaten three guys
in Booker's
ever.
Entire illustrious career. He could come up with three fucking names.
One of whom means dirt nothing.
So, then they got in a big what have you, and then out came Sting, and I guess he's going to challenge the winner. He'll be at the pay-per-view.
That was what was established here. He said he'll be there, and Tenay and West went, yay! And I thought, who cares?
We're supposed to.
We're supposed to be excited.
He's in the rafters,
Vince. He's going to be there.
He was in the rafters. I mean, come on. In 1997, this was fucking huge when he was in the rafters. So, fuck, why wouldn't it work again? So, then we had the Kurt Angle, Velvet Sky, and Angelina Love against AJ, ODB, and Gale. Girls did some stuff, and then AJ and Kurt tagged in, and then Frank Trigg came out, and then Karen came out, and...
Yes, Karen Angle came out to counter Frank Trigg.
Yeah. So, anyway, ended up with all four girls in the ring at the same time, and of course, ref didn't care, because it's TNA. AJ did a dive on a Kurt, and Kurt caught him with his neck again. And then Gale pinned Velvet with a neck breaker. And, of course, afterwards, again, the heels attacked the baby faces. Angle went to put AJ in the ankle lock. But Karen ran in and gave Kurt a low blow. And then Trig came in and beat up AJ, and so Angle just put him right back in the ankle lock. So what was the fucking point of cutting off Kurt when he was putting the guy in the ankle lock?
Well, we've often asked, what exactly is Karen Angle's job? Apparently it's to nut Kurt Angle.
Great. Well, I'm just going to move on. This show's over.
This show sucks. And let it be known.
This show's concluded.
The final build for Victory Road was Kurt Angle, who was not in the main event, putting AJ Styles, who was not in the main event, in an ankle lock.
Yeah. I hate this program. To the back! This was a TNA pay-per-view. It was, I don't even know the name of this pay-per-view. Victory Road.
Houston Road.
I don't know.
It was TNA, the show from Houston.
It was a TNA show that was built up rather poorly on television and ended up being, I don't know.
It started off awesome and ended shitty.
It started off, yeah.
The pay-per-view in four words, or eight words.
This was a pay-per-view with a long downward slide, starting with
almost linear.
Well, no, because there was a great, they had
the tag match was fun.
There was a six-man or something like that, just got a PM from Jubs. Favorite pay-per-view of the year. How?
Well, he's retarded.
How can you enjoy this? How can you say this was... Okay, even if you love TNA, I can name... What month is this?
July.
I can name six pay-per-views better than this one this year.
Yeah.
Just from TNA. The opener was great, but man, that main event was just bullshit. And there was a lot
and designed
of,
bullshit.
There was a lot of stuff on this show that offended me in a number of different ways. But we might as well get started, and I'll just go through it match by match. The opener, as noted, was great. It was Puma, Masato Yoshino, Milano Collection AT, that was Team Japan, against Ultimo Guerrero, Rey Bucanero, and Averno, that's Team Mexico, Tyson Dukes, Alex Kozlov, who's going to be the guest later this week,
woo!
And Doug Williams, they were Team International, and then Curry Man, Chris Sabin, and Alex Shelley, which were Team TNA, and it was great. My only complaint is that it went maybe a little bit too long. There was a period there at the end where there were a few near falls kicked out of that, quite frankly, just didn't need to be kicked out of. This match had gone on long enough. The people were into it. It was just a little bit of extra stuff at the end that you probably did not need. With that said, it was great. Standouts in this match, who do we have? Yoshino was awesome.
Mm-hmm. Ultimo Guerrero, fucking Guerrero.
And Rey Bucanero were awesome.
Both of them, yes.
Alex Kozlov was awesome.
The Machine Guns
really were awesome.
Almost everyone stood out.
Yeah, Doug Williams didn't have much chance to stand out.
He didn't do much. He did a cool suplex. Tyson Dukes, I don't remember doing anything.
He was eliminated immediately.
Yeah.
And Curry Man also did not have a chance to do all that much. And Puma and Milano Collection AT were good, but didn't stand out like the other guys here.
No, but there was so much love. There are nitpicks. It was very hard at some points to remember who was on whose team. Matching colors would have helped here.
Yeah.
And it was virtually impossible to this whole tournament's designed so poorly. They were talking about how there was 3 points for the winner, 2 points for runner-up, and 1 point for the third-place team.
Impossible to keep track of.
But even worse, they were explaining that, say, Team TNA would have survived, all three of them, they then would have been first, second, and third and gotten all the points. That's dumb.
What? I don't even want to think about this.
Okay,
don't even think about it, everybody.
The fact that I'm not clear on this indicates they fucked up.
You're a sports fan.
Yeah.
You should understand these stats.
I should.
I did not. But yeah, it was a great
match. As
far
as what they did, awesome.
I gave it 4 stars. That may be low. It was, every spot you can think of. The Guerreros, and there was a moment where the Guerreros and the Machine Guns were facing off, and I must see that match soon.
Please.
It was actually more a problem with my own personal paying attention, but there was an issue at the end where I thought it came down to the Guerreros and the Machine Guns, and I was like, this is going to be great. And then more dudes just kept coming in.
Well,
there were a lot of periods where guys vanished, and you couldn't remember who'd been eliminated.
Right.
There were just 4 guys in the ring, and you were like, okay, are these the last 4 guys left, or what the hell's going on?
They needed a scoreboard on screen.
If you could ignore all of these small little nitpicks, then it was 2 thumbs up. And I'll give it 2 thumbs up, especially when you look at the rest of this pay-per-view.
Yes, it was awesome, and as noted, it was not by far, but it was the best match in the show.
Came down to Yoshino and Shelley, tons of near falls, And then Shelley hit him with the Celtic Cross for the pin.
Yeah, the other story was that Yoshino's two teammates were eliminated early. So he had to go on his own for a long, long time and almost pulled it off.
He was great. So that left Team TNA with 6 points, which is odd that you'd have Team TNA in first place until we found out that they didn't win. Team Japan was in second place with 4 points. Team International and Team Mexico were tied for third. And they announced that Ultimate X was worth like 5 points. So essentially they were just saying, all of these matches didn't mean jack shit.
No.
Because whoever wins that match just wins the entire thing.
Yes.
So there you go. And then we add the first of what were some fantastic segments.
Unreal.
With Booker T. Booker T took us on a tour of his home. He has a place in his home called the African Room.
Where he goes
to meditate.
To meditate.
Yeah.
And he said this forcefully.
He said he'd been given a key to the city by the mayor. And did Samoa Joe have one of those? No. And he also brought in Sharmell for a cameo, and
there was the Wall of Achievement where he has all his Pro Wrestling Illustrated plaques.
Sure, yeah.
This is all so great. He showed off his cars. It was basically Cribs with Booker T.
Yeah.
And it was every bit as awesome as that sounds.
Then we had Angelina Love and Gail Kim, which was an acceptable battle. It wasn't great. There was nothing wrong with it. It was just two girls had a basic match,
yeah.
And Gail won.
Good.
The highlight was Velvet Sky's jeans. And what more is there to say? That was the highlight of this match.
They were pretty awesome. The low light.
She interfered. She interfered.
You were
regularly.
Fine with this? Yes.
I was fine with this. She should have just been in the match in that outfit. And what was the low light?
The low light was the crowd chanting, "You screwed Brett at Earl Hebner." Listen, everyone. It is 2008.
This was 11 years ago.
11 goddamn years ago.
Yeah.
Move on. All of you.
I'll tell you what the best part of this match was. First, they did this match. Everything was fine. And then, of course, Velvet hit the ring afterwards to beat up Gail. And they're pummeling her. And Velvet gets the bag. So Gail's down. And they've beaten on her. And they've got the bag. What comes next?
They put the bag on her head?
You would think. Instead, they've got the bag in their hand. And they pick her up, and they begin whipping her into the ropes. And I thought, now what are you going to do?
Hold the bag out and then run into it?
That's what I thought. Are you going to hold the bag out and she's going to run headfirst into the bag?
She's going to run and bend over.
That would have been the best thing ever. Unfortunately, she grabbed the ropes and bailed, and so I never got to see what the end of this ingenious plan was.
And then they played her music.
Yeah.
But she didn't win.
That pissed me off. I wanted them to whip her into the bag.
Well, maybe it's just a tease. Maybe they'll pee it off on the impact.
It could be. It could be.
The running bag put on.
I love that the bag, I love how over the bag is. That's just the best.
Brown paper bag, and they put it on people's heads. That is awesome.
It is awesome. So then Lauren was backstage with fans, and boy were these fans. This was every stereotype you've ever imagined about professional wrestling fans. They were there for the country whipping match, and I was sitting there going, I didn't know B.G. James was in this match.
I thought he was one of the fans. I thought he wasn't qualified.
It could have been. Apparently, he's now a backstage interviewer.
Much like Shane Douglas.
I don't recall this.
Well, no, they never made an announcement.
No, this was something that was announced, I believe, maybe it was on TNA Wrestling. I know it was announced in Dave's Update.
It was?
Perhaps they figured everybody read Dave's Update.
No.
I don't know.
There. I think it's a good move. I compared it to Shane Douglas, and it's not quite as bad because I don't hate watching Road Dogg wrestle like I hated watching Shane Douglas wrestle, but they're both really, really good interviewers. So,
sure.
Hell, that's a good use for him.
It is,
cool.
Sort of. I'd rather see him. It seems a waste to take a man with the talent of BG and have him do interviews. Plus, he's so fucking big.
He is
and
giant,
everyone
that's
in this
true.
Company is so small.
Yeah.
Do you really need him interviewing Petey?
Or the Machine Guns, yes.
Or the Machine Guns.
You tiny little men.
So anyway, then we had Black Machismo and Sonjay Dutt, who had a match with not a whole lot of heat. And if you remember, for a while, people were really into this. They really were into Sonjay as a heel and Lethal as a babyface. No more. And if you're wondering why, I can... Two words, pink taco. And another two words, yoga ball. Tells you everything you
yes,
need to know.
Indeed.
Yes, those segments were entertaining. Yes, they were funny. Nobody takes comedy seriously.
There's a reason it's called comedy.
Impossible to take this match seriously. They did a bunch of moves and such, and let's see, we had a lethal combination, and he refused to get the pin, and then Val jumped on the apron to say something. Apparently, I don't know if she didn't want the men to fight anymore. This was not clear.
They're okay.
As is everything in TNA.
Nothing is ever clear, no. But the finish was Val destructed Jay.
She destructed him.
Distracted him, and he was then pinned by Sonjay. Okay, I can deal with that. It was preceded by Val distracting Jay and Jay not getting pinned. Why? If that's going to be the finish, why don't you just do it at the finish?
Well, did you need to make sure people knew she was involved?
I see. Well, that's for the people at home.
No, when she distracted Lethal, I was trying to figure out what she was. I could have sworn she was indicating, I don't want you two men to fight. And yeah, I was like, why?
I don't know.
Because he gave you a card?
Yes, at the
beginning. Because Dutt gave you a card and a rose at the beginning of the match. You now have a soft spot in your heart for this.
Apparently, that won her over.
That ruined your wedding.
That ruined your wedding.
If I ruin a girl's wedding, all I need is a card and a rose, and she'll be fine.
Indeed, girls are superficial, you see.
I guess so.
Yes, but the fans in the building may have been needed to be reminded that Val was at ringside. The fans at home cannot miss this because the shitty TNA director was so concerned we knew what Val was doing that they would do a move and then they would show Val.
Yeah.
If it was Jay Lethal hitting a move, she would smile and go. And then Jay would do a move, and they'd show Val.
The best was when he cut away, and randomly we got the boom.
Yeah, there was a shot of the boom mic is hanging out, and then Dutt would hit a move, and they'd go to Val, and she'd put her hand over her mouth, and she'd be very concerned, like Elizabeth, and just, we get it. Val is there. Show us the match.
So then
you fucked hard.
Sonjay kissed her hand afterwards as she backed up the ramp looking all confused, and then it was to the back! Yeah.
Sonjay won.
Yeah, nothing can sink in TNA because it's always to the back.
So, yes, true.
So then Darth Vader, dude, said that coming up next, LAX would face, and I quote, beer money and 12 angry fans. Now, I just want to know why the fans were so angry. They won a contest to whip the heels. What were they so angry about?
I don't know.
Did beer money steal their beer money?
Likely, actually.
From looking at them, that's a possibility. Beer Money then cut a promo on both LAX and I quote, the Marks, that were going to be involved, threatened to beat the shit out of anybody that strapped them. In fact, James Storm was begging for it. And normally I would rant and rave about, why use a term like Marks when nobody knows what that term means? But then I realized that every single person that buys this pay-per-view
yes.
knows what that term means, because no casual fan buys these shows.
If Triple H said it, that would be dumb.
Yes.
If James Storm says it because it's TNA, that's fine.
Doesn't matter.
But Jackie refused to go out there. She wouldn't get whipped. No how, nothing.
No, she feared for her life. Then we had LAX versus Beer Money, and as noted, you should have seen these lumberjacks.
What? Geeks!
And the best part, just for no reason, they go, we have 12 lumberjacks plus an alternate.
Because everything in TNA has to be more complicated than it should be. Yes, it's not enough they have 12. It's not even that they had an extra guy and said, okay, we'll just make it a beggar's dozen, here's 13. No, there was an alternate in case one of the strappers got hurt.
He may have collapsed. He may have
gone on strike. Maybe he wanted some other benefit.
Went to lunch in the middle of this match.
It may have been a no-show.
Yeah, an alternate. So anyway, they had a match. And, of course, the heels got strapped. The best was Storm going outside and making sure that he ran in front of every single mark.
He did a complete lap around ringside.
He did.
And, he by the way, he did not kick their ass afterwards.
Now, there
was
an Ultimate X match. There was a TLC match. There was a Tornado Cibernetico match. And what was the best spot on the show? Let me tell you. It was a spot where Beer Money picked up Homicide during the heat, and they gave him a double suplex. Yes, two men suplexing one. And upon landing, they leaped to their feet, and James Storm screamed, beer!
And then Robert Roode screamed, money!
And then they raised their hands in victory as if they'd won Olympic medals. And they cheered
they were
and celebrated.
So happy to have hit this double suplex.
On Homicide.
On Homicide.
On the diminutive Homicide.
On the 160-pound Homicide. And Storm jumped up, and he loves beer. So he throws his hands up, and he screamed, beer! And then Robert Roode said, money! And he watched it. Five times?
It was awesome.
It never got old.
So then the Super Mechs ran wild, and then they pinned Storm or somebody with the Gringo Cutter off the shoulders. And all I have to say is bullshit.
The wrong team won.
The wrong team
that is
won.
Blatantly clear.
And they did hardly anything with this lumberjack gimmick. If you're going to do the gimmick, do it.
They
were out there at the beginning. That was it.
No, that the very finish, Robert Roode, he charged, went over the top, got whipped, and then he hit the finisher on him.
Well.
I don't know what else they could have done. Bring the fans into the ring.
Sure. I wanted more whippings.
Okay, there could have been more whippings. But, yes, it was aside from the whippings at the beginning and the end, in the middle, just your very basic tag match, and that is two thumbs up.
We had more with Booker T in school training dudes. Boy, you should have seen these dudes. They should have been the Lumberjacks, actually. So they interviewed the wrestlers who said such things as, Booker T taught me how to be a man. And he has a hell of a school.
Yes, he does.
It was huge.
It is
there
better
was, like,
than
two rings. And I just thought, you know,
hammer strength equipment everywhere.
The fact that WWE did not take advantage of this in any way.
Cards.
Idiots.
Yes.
So, why do I preach to the choir? TNA hasn't taken advantage of this yet.
That's also, well, they did here, kind of.
Taylor against Awesome Kong for the TNA title. This was a 5-minute battle. It was acceptable. Kong beat on her, took a few bumps. Taylor made a big comeback and won with a cradle. And TNA was screaming about how she'd done the impossible twice! That's impossible. Is it not?
Well, it was.
How do you do the impossible twice?
That's it. You're right, Brian. That would be impossible. But what was impossible to me was that Mike Tenay was so impressed that she won, but they both forgot how. Because they did the exact same finish from Thursday on the show, and this time Kong kicked out, but neither one referenced it.
Yeah.
And they did another roll-up, and Taylor won this time. So it was short. It was fine.
And then Raisha wiped her out.
Oh, my God, she killed her.
Beat the crap out of her, and they set up a chair for Kong to do the power bomb. But who should make the save but Abyss? Abyss, everybody! Apparently he's making the save for the
anyone really
huddled masses yearning
to not get beaten.
I guess
yes.
So.
It's arbitrary because there are often times a babyface is beaten and Abyss does not come out. But at random points when a babyface is outnumbered getting squashed, Abyss will come out to be a monster and save the day.
So Pork hit Raisha with the black hole slam after she slapped him. And they were making a note that Cornette was not there, since, of course, he drives to shows, and Houston apparently was too far away. And
the best thing is they couldn't think of an excuse. They just said, he's not here.
They should just said he won't fly.
Yeah. There's a reason. They just said Cornette's not here. I thought, did he have a really important tennis match he couldn't get out of?
So anyway, they said he wouldn't be happy about that, and then Abyss carried Taylor to the back like a hero afterwards, and how sweet.
What a tag match that's going to be.
Then we had more with Booker T. He was at a restaurant that he owned that they called Sharmell's, and they had a hidden camera that caught him telling the guy in charge to charge the most amount of money for the least amount of food.
Yes, make the portion smaller and water down all the booze.
All right. I might as well make mention of this now. Everybody knew Booker was going to be cheered in Houston. TNA knew that Booker T was going to be cheered in Houston. So why would you spend 4 segments... putting him over as such a heel. Explain this to me.
Well, they're dumb. They're dumb, dumb, dumb.
That's the only logical explanation.
Moreover, if you're going to do these awesome segments, why not air them on the Impact leading up to the show?
Well?
They're dumb.
They're not very smart.
No. Segments are entertaining. Kind of misguided.
Volador, Daivari, Kaz, and Naruki Doi. 3 guys have never been in Ultimate X. I think Kaz has. I don't remember. So, it's kind of rough going a little bit there early, and did a bunch of stuff, fell off things, you know the deal. Volador did a bunch of lucha here and there, and no heat. I mean,
well, maybe because the crowd had no idea who 3 of these guys were.
No, the bigger issue is that when you do a Torneo Cibernético in the opener and then try and do an Ultimate X later, it just ain't happening.
Yeah.
But they did their stuff.
I should note, at the end of the opener, Don West admitted, I'm already exhausted.
Yeah.
That's bad.
So, the finish was the notable thing. Daivari started to scale the cables, and he was underneath them, kind of tethering across, or whatever you call it, and Kaz suddenly leaped from the scaffold and gave him a leg drop to knock him off of the cables. And Kaz ended up falling, I swear to God, it had to be 10 to 12 feet, right onto his side. How this man was not killed, I have no idea. The stupidest thing I've seen in years, actually.
It was high on the list.
And he landed and was killed, and then Volador climbed up and got the X and won. And Kaz, this is not his first stupid bump.
No, no.
This guy takes more stupid bumps than, I mean, he's Trump's AJ. AJ used to take all sorts of dumb ones. He's smartened up. Not Kaz. This guy, sadly, will probably be in a wheelchair before all is said and done at this rate. We gotta slow down. Why?
I don't know. And
for this match!
It was basically the same bump that Matt Hardy took. Remember his cage match with the Edge when Matt did one with the leg drop off the top of the cage?
Yes.
That was really, really dumb. You know, no, Matt doesn't even do the leg drop off the second rope anymore. But at least Matt won that match.
Yeah.
Kaz killed himself here and then lost.
Yeah, in storyline, this stupid move cost him the match.
It did, yes.
So he's dumb for doing this move.
Indeed.
So anyway, afterwards we got the big celebration with Team Mexico.
This was so great. They did a UFC moment where they had the winners, and they did interviews, and there was a translator because they didn't speak English.
Unfortunately, well, luckily, actually, this Volador fellow cut a way better promo than any of the foreigners in UFC.
That is a good point.
And
so did Ultimo Guerrero.
So did he, yes. And then afterwards, they did the big celebratory Guerrero's dance, and it was great.
The highlight was for both Volador and Ultimo Guerrero, they spoke for a little bit of time. 15, 20 seconds. They both said Viva La Raza. And then they had Willie Urbina there to do translation, and he translated it as like a, he is proud and happy. Thanks, Will.
Sure. Yeah, so I think in Houston they figured the Mexicans winning would get over. It didn't. Or it was just a deal where CMLL said, okay, Mexicans got to win. We'll give you our guys. But regardless, this was fine.
This was a great moment, actually. I love this.
And we had more with Booker. This time he was at a golf course, which he claimed he owned. And I should note, I was rough on these earlier because they make no sense that you would build this man up as a heel on a show where you know he's going to be cheered in his hometown. But these were golden. Booker T is the greatest man I've ever seen. He should be the champion forever.
Of everything.
Of everything.
He should just have 18 belts and carry them around. He noted that before he took a swing at the golf course, he pulled out the tee and said, I'm inventing these, Booker T's. Take four strokes off your golf game.
Yeah.
And hit a big drive. And he was in the country club with guys telling him, you're going to be the show. We're all going to celebrate. It's going to be a great time. And then he closed and said, Joe, beating you is going to be as easy as sinking this putt. And he hit the putt, got in the golf cart, and drove away. Awesome.
Then we had Angle and Team 3D against Rhino, Christian, and AJ in the Full Metal Mayhem match. Obviously, everybody was very concerned that Kurt would be destroyed during this match, but in fact, the guy that got hurt was Devon Dudley, who did a simple clothesline off the top to put AJ or somebody through a table with a, who was it? Who were they putting through the
Rhino.
Table?
It was Rhino.
All right, whoever. Anyway, he landed wrong and blew out his ankle, and it was very clear that he was hurt, and he got it through the entire match, so you got to give the guy credit for that. But I don't know if he twisted it or if he broke it or what the deal was, but that did not look comfortable.
It looked like he twisted it. They put it, as noted, they put Rhino through a table with a clothesline, so Devon had to clear the table on the jump, and I think that threw him off. And, yeah, bad landing, and it looked like he twisted his ankle. He was walking on it, putting weight on it, and then screaming in pain, so that's bad, but hopefully he's okay. But the match was a kind of a cluster. They jumped off the high things. They hit each other with weapons. They brawled at ringside. They had finishers. The best part about this match to me is that out of all, you had all these weapons, and by the way, even though it was a TLC match, they were still pinfalls. So to pin your opponent to win. But out of all this, they still had the tables. Going through a table equals instant and complete death.
Sure.
Guys went through tables and they were never seen again. It happened literally 5 times in a row. So at least the table still means something.
I guess it's not TLC because there were trash cans also involved. I guess TLC is just a hardcore match.
Well, I guess. I don't know. They call it Full Metal Mayhem, which makes me ask, are the tables made of metal? Because that would suck.
Well, they got metal underneath them.
I see.
I don't know what the deal was. But anyway, Christian's the dumbest guy in this match. He took a, what did he do? He took a belly-to-belly onto a ladder from Angle. And even Angle was smart enough to not land on the ladder. And then he did a high cross off the scaffold on all three heels. And thankfully, actually it was on the two heels because Angle wasn't even close to him.
No.
Angle was avoiding everything in this match.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, that's smart and all. But I don't know if that means he's hurt or if he smartened up at some point recently.
Hopefully the latter, probably both.
He's got to be feeling better because he was bigger than he was last month. So that's at least a positive. But he didn't do anything overly stupid in this entire match and he never got hurt. So that was good. And... there was the usual TNA idiocy. We had Johnny Devine ran in with a stick, and ref was just right there, didn't care, and Of course, he used the stick for a while, and then Angle or AJ hit him with the stick. And so anyway, it was made clear that it doesn't matter if people run in.
Right.
This is apparently a no DQ match. So once that's established, what do they immediately do?
A ref bump.
Yeah, Earl Hebner's take a bump. Why? I don't know. So then AJ climbed a ladder, and Trigg whacked him with the kendo stick, and then Angle hit him with the slam through a table. And I guess the idea was the ref shouldn't be able to see Trigg. But apparently it was okay if he's... I just don't get it. It's okay if he sees the one geek, but not the other geek.
Well, Devine's Canadian, so he doesn't count.
Oh, because her...
I don't know.
Anyway, the point is this, of course, as usual, made absolutely no sense. And
right.
It just baffles me. I mean, nobody writing this stuff thinks, why is that legal, but we need a ref bump for this illegal act? No one thinks about this?
No.
Or is it just, WWE main events have ref bumps, so we've just got to do it?
I don't have an answer for that, Brian. If you ignore the stupidity, the story was good, and they eliminated Christian Rhino and then had AJ alone against three heels. And again, he almost pulled it off, but got trigged and put through a table and pinned. So if you turn your brain off, it was fun. If not, well, it was dumb.
And we got the main event, which ended up being a disaster. It was Joe versus Booker. Of course, as noted, everybody cheered Booker and hated Joe. Didn't get nearly the reaction I expected. I guess I didn't really expect a Bret Hart in Canada sort of reaction, but I expected something. And didn't get it. So anyway, the match was just back-ass words. They got in there, and of course... All right.
It's like they knew... They knew Joe was going to be booed, and they knew Booker would be cheered.
I mean, this was so patently obvious.
Yeah,
they knew in advance, it happened, and then what did they do? They had Joe work as a babyface.
Yes.
They got the heat on Joe, which, of course, nobody cared about. How do you get sympathy on a guy you hate?
Well,
and then Joe makes a comeback.
And they booed.
And they were mad, and they didn't care.
Yes.
So this was a mess, and they kept showing Sharmell, and... And,
yeah, the what I said for Val during the earlier match goes for Sharmell here. They would show these guys doing a move, and they cut to Sharmell every single time.
Now,
annoying.
I have no idea what happened, but apparently Joe started beating on him, and Booker got busted open, and they were selling it like Booker was just done, like he'd been destroyed. And, of course, when you've seen everything we've seen on the show...
Guys falling off cables. Going through tables, getting hit with trash cans...
Booker bleeding didn't mean anything.
Oh.
Worse, Joe had been busted open hard away, and they were bleeding the exact same amount.
Indeed.
So, they're trying to sell this like Booker's just unable to continue, and Joe keeps beating on him. And then finally, they ended up outside, and Sharmell slapped Joe, so he beat up all the students. And then finally, Sting hit the ring, and once again, he's going on about how, Joe, you've gone too far. And of course, the question remains, why has he gone too far? He is beating him up a little
bit.
He's
having a wrestling match, and he's trying to beat his opponent so they can pin him when the referee wakes up.
This is too much for Sting. So, of course, Joe left the ring, but then turned around and ran back to destroy Booker. And then Sting tried to stop him, but Joe flipped him off, so Sting beat him up with the bat. And then Booker made the cover, and Sharmell counted the pin, and they played Booker's music, and she gave him the title.
And then the show ended. None of this...
What?
This is the main event disaster. The main event, no finish on a pay-per-view. All of you who saw this paid your money and didn't get the finish of the main event. And I say again, by design, this happened the way they wanted it to. This was their plan. They thought this would be cool.
Chris here writes, just want some clarification between me and my friends who split the money for this show. Thank God it didn't completely suck. Is Booker T champ, or is it just a no contest? I'm figuring no contest, but this is TNA we're talking about. The same company would have a title change 2 days before their pay-per-view. The answer is, I don't know.
None of us knows what's going on.
I'm sure they'll just say Joe is still champion.
Probably.
I think the idea was, I don't know what the idea was. Well, were they thinking we'll give Booker the title in his hometown and people will think he won, and then we'll fuck him, number one. And number two, people booed Booker T when this was over because it was such bullshit.
As it was so dumb. It's such a disaster in every way. And there are many, many questions I could ask here, but if the finish was going to end in this, you know, kind of double-turn fashion, why not just have Joe be a heel the whole match?
What?
Well, by the end of this match, Joe was a mad lunatic who was supposedly preying on the helpless Booker T as being a bully. If you're going to do that for the finish, Why not just have him be a heel the whole way since he's going to be booed anyway?
I don't know, Vince.
Why was Don West begging for someone to help Booker, or help Booker T, but then when Sting hit Joe, why was Don West outraged at this?
I don't know. I don't understand anything that's going on here. So anyway.
This is bullshit,
that
everyone.
That gets a thumbs down.
Jesus Christ, this is annoying. This show sucked just because of that. Everyone,
this does harken back to the days of WCW where they would have a great undercard.
Yes.
They would have a great undercard, but then they'd have this horrible main event, and that would just stick in your craw. And the main event was so bad that you left the show angry.
Yeah.
And you just completely forgot all the good stuff.
Yes.
You were just so mad about how the main event was so lame that you just didn't like the entire thing. So, anyway, kids, that's it for this review.
To the back!
All right. I hate to talk about this show. This was bad programming, everybody. First off, they recapped the pay-per-view, and they said that Sunday night was a night when the world was watching TNA. That's what they said. The world was watching. Lie.
And stolen.
And then they jumped back to 1997 in the naming of this show. The title of the program was Why Sting Why? Wow.
You've got to be kidding me.
Of course not. Then Booker and Sharmell arrived, clutching the TNA World title belt. Booker was wearing a jacket he had apparently stolen from John Morrison. They came down to the ring, and people chanted, "You suck," so apparently he's a heel still. And he cut a promo about how he proved to everybody that Joe could not beat him, and that he was the greatest champion of all time. He said his lovely wife had counted the pin. "Well, Samoa Joe lie lifeless," he said. And, of course, out came Cornette, and he demanded Booker give the belt back since Joe was still champion. And you could hear people booing this, of course, but still largely cheers. He said the two would rematch at Hard Justice, but didn't mention anything else. And out came Joe wearing a suit and tie. And Booker went on this big rant about how Joe could have the belt if he wanted to, but Joe had to know that he did not and could not beat him at the pay-per-view. Now, I know that most of you listening to this didn't actually see the pay-per-view, but I could have sworn that in that match, that what was supposed to have happened, and of course, this didn't work out in execution, but in theory, Joe had beaten him so bad that everybody was trying to just get the match stopped for, I guess, to save Booker's life.
That is the feeling I had leaving the show, yes.
Well, apparently, because he didn't pin him, he was not the dominant man. Anyway, so Booker said, "Here, you can have your damn belt." And Joe said, "I've never taken a handout from a punk, and I never will." A handout! It's stolen property, mind you. But if you return stolen property, apparently that's now a handout. So he said he would win it back at Hard Justice. He was going to take a piece of Booker's ass with it and told him to hold on to the belt until the pay-per-view. Hold on to the belt till the pay-per-view. Why would you do that? Why, if you're just going to have a guy pretend he's a champion for an entire month and hold on to the belt during that entire period, why just put the belt on him for a month?
I don't know. I don't have an answer for that. Nothing makes sense, dude.
Then Lauren came out. I don't need commentary from you yet, Vince. You didn't even see it. It's significantly worse. Then Lauren came out and interviewed Beer Money. And, of course, she makes fun of the heels, but then is offended when they yell at her for it. That sounds familiar. So they said they couldn't sleep for a week due to the welts on their back, and now they're going to go on a mission and beat the shit out of fans. And then they grabbed Lauren and took her on this mission. Then we had Borash interviewing Kaz, who I could have sworn was a babyface, but maybe I'm wrong, because he proceeded to cry about how he'd lost on Sunday, and he had let down all of the TNA wrestlers, past and present, who had ever been in the X Division. He let down the whole world. Bitch, 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 bitch. So then he got a chance to redeem himself in a match with Petey Williams. Now, I could be wrong, but I could have sworn that Petey Williams was a heel and Kaz was a babyface. You would not know this from watching this match, because Petey ran wild at the beginning and then did his wacky pescado into a Hurricane Rana outside. Everybody was cheering and chanting Petey's name, and then he got the heat on Kaz. Yeah. So then he's beating on Kaz, and Kaz makes a comeback, and they trade a bunch of near falls here in the opener, including Kaz hitting his same finish that everyone else uses, the fall-away thingamajigger, Kennedy's wacky, whatever the fuck you call it. Anyway, the point is he hit his move, and of course, Petey kicked out here in the opener. So then Raka Khan took the ref. Then she hit the ring, which was not a DQ. And then after hitting every fucking big move you can possibly think of, Petey rolled him up and pulled the ties for the pin. Enraged me. Enraged me. And Kaz failed again. So he's got to be turning heel. And then it gets better. Soon as he loses, it's to the back. What's it to the back for, you ask? Well, it went to the back because Borash was there to interview Petey. They had to cut away from the match to go backstage to wait for the guy in the match to come back for the interview. Swear to God. But then as he's about to interview, up walked Eric Young, who started talking about the Prince Justice Brotherhood. And I was just thinking, well, where's the Petey interview? And we never got it. That was the end of the segment. Then we had more bullshit with Joe and Nash. Nash walked in, and he's trying to be friends with Joe again. Gave a pep talk. Joe didn't want to hear it. Joe, the babyface, the world champion, was practically in tears. He basically said that he had tried to put Booker T in a coma at the pay-per-view and failed. And apparently, near coma is not enough for Samoa Joe. So Nash was trying to explain that Joe won the match, and even though Joe beat the man within an inch of his life, to the point where everybody was trying to get the match stopped because he'd supposedly beaten the man so bad, Joe's like, well, who left with the belt? It wasn't me. And he put his head down and nearly cried. This is your champion, everybody. This is your TNA champion of the world.
This is your hero.
Your hero.
This is the guy you're supposed to love and cheer for and adore. Wow. I got here in the middle of this, and it was even shittier than I thought, because I didn't know about the earlier thing with Booker T. I thought the show opened with this bullshit. But no, yeah, this is, wow. That's astounding. That is truly astounding.
Then we went to the production truck where Beer Money was beating the crew, yeehaw. And then a limo pulled up and out came Kurt and Team 3D wearing sting masks. It's 2008, everybody. Borash immediately knew who Angle was despite the mask. And then all of a sudden he looks over in an alley and there's Super Eric Sharkboy and Curry Man having a meeting about how to get rid of the filth of TNA. If only they could succeed. And then in ran Beer Money to beat them up. No buys.
Well, the end of it was, because they were having a very annoying conversation filled with all kind of stupid jokes like, Curry Man? No, I'm Curry Man. So I was quite relieved to see two men running with belts and beat the piss out of them. But, yeah, everything up to this point was very, very lame. Kurt Angle and Team 3D playing Halloween. That's not cool.
Matt Morgan against Jimmy Rave. Speaking of 1997, we got a Goldberg squash here. And I am actually stunned that Matt Morgan did not just use the jackhammer. He actually did the vertical suplex into the urinage. May as well use a jackhammer. And he beat Jimmy Rave. And then out came Lance Hoyt, who has now, quote, legally changed his name to Lance Rock. You know, Rock and Rave infection.
The funniest thing is it took them 6 months to think of that.
So, of course, Morgan pinned him quickly in a Goldberg-style squash, but not, of course, before Lance Rock got to do his moonsault, of course. Had to get his shit in. So, whoop-de-doo. There you go.
He beat two men quickly, he being Morgan, and the fans chanted his name, and I thought, wow, that was simple. Why didn't he win that six-man last week?
Because they're fools.
Ah, okay, I see.
Then we had all the girls bitching backstage, yelling and screaming all over themselves.
This is such horrible TV.
And then Cornette screamed louder than everybody to shut him up, which lasted about 2 seconds before they all started bitching again. How millions of people did not turn the channel during the segment, I have no idea. So
he's squawking and squabbling.
He said there was a new Knockouts champion, and tonight they were going to have a, of course, gauntlet match, and the winner got a title shot. At least it wasn't a pole. It's either a gauntlet or a pole in this company, and this time we got the gauntlet. And then the one with the boobs, who I believe Tracy said Cornette should take her up on what she'd offered, and he said consider it. And again, of course, as is always in TNA, they never explain what he was talking about. And of course, because this happens all the time, just nobody cares.
No, not at all. Not even a little. But yeah, this is some wretched, wretched TV right here. And it was followed by an announcement for a new interview segment next week entitled Karen's Angle, in which Karen Angle is going to have a talk show. She's going to interview people. She announced this would be thought-provoking. That was a lie. And I watched this promo and I thought, no one, not one person on the earth, could see this promo and think, I can't wait till this week. I can't wait to see Karen's Angle. That's going to be fun. No, no one thought that. They all thought, that's going to suck.
I will guarantee this segment will be 30 seconds long every week, and we will wonder what the point of it is. Beer Money was beating up security. There was more screaming involved. I don't ever want to hear screaming again. And then we had Angle and Team 3D coming out in their Sting masks. And he mentioned their big win at Victory Road, which I would bet that most of you that watched that pay-per-view didn't even remember who won that match.
I actually wrote down, they're out to celebrate. I forgot that they won.
Yes. They said the world wanted to know why Sting attacked Joe with a bat at the pay-per-view. I was unaware that this was a mystery. I thought that Sting wanted Joe to just stop because he was going to kill a man. And then Joe ignored him and ran back in there to continue trying to kill this guy. And so Sting saved the man's life.
And Joe then flicked him off.
What's the mystery here?
Yeah, it's very simple, really.
And apparently not.
Apparently not to anyone in total nonstop action.
So he said that Sting did this because of something, disrespect or something. Anyway, he said he had talked to Sting last night, which the announcers didn't believe. And when the announcers don't believe something on this show, that's saying something right there. So AJ, Christian, and Rhino came out. AJ said nobody knew why Sting did it except Sting, and I guess anybody with a brain. They yelled back and forth, and then we got typical TNA bullshit. Bubba's like, let's have a rematch at Hard Justice. And if you recall, at the last pay-per-view, it was fan voting, and the fans voted for Full Metal Mayhem. What's the follow-up to Full Metal Mayhem at Hard Justice? Why, a tables match. They're doing a match with less dips than the first match that three teams had. So Bubba announces this match, and then AJ is like, or Christian actually says, well, you can't make the rules. Let's do it next week. On TV for free. And it'll be a five-table elimination match. And even though Bubba didn't like this idea, didn't complain. So the match is just taking place Christian, for free on TV next week.
Christian outbooked him.
I guess so.
He apparently is higher in the totem pole. Because he said, no, you don't get to make the match, I do. And he did, and everyone said, okay.
What an irony that one person had an idea that might make money, thus that being a match on pay-per-view, and the other dipshit had a match that's going to make no money, that being given away for free, and the dipshit won out.
I also like...
That's TNA in a nutshell right there, everybody.
It's not a bad point.
There are 3 weeks between pay-per-views. The pay-per-view's like August 10th. You realize that? It's like I don't even know if that's 3 weeks away. Yeah, it's 3 weeks away. Wait a second. How many weeks away is that?
I'd rather be like 17 weeks away.
It is 1, 2 Oh, I guess it is 4 weeks away. God, that's a long time from now. Anyway. Is that right? Oh. That sucks. Anyway. Yeah. But still, the big show's next week, not at the pay-per-view.
Yes. I also like that Bubba was okay. He wanted the tables match. That was the match he wanted. But when Christian said it'd be an elimination tables match, Bubba was not cool with this. I guess that changes the entire game.
I don't know.
This was long and it was dumb, and it was annoying that not one person knew. No one could understand Sting's motivation. The same people who pointed out that Booker T was beaten to the point of death, that his life was saved, they couldn't understand why Sting saved him.
Yeah. Someone's just going to explain, well, they're heels. Oh, okay. We had a knockouts gauntlet match.
But AJ didn't know either.
To determine the number one contender for Taylor. Kong, of course, wasn't in this match. And then we had, it's just a bunch of girls. I'm not going to list them all. It was a Royal Rumble with 1 minute intervals. There was the usual idiocy, such as Jackie doing an arm bar, and it got broken up when Gail got the ropes. Why? What the fuck does getting the ropes have to do in a battle royal? It's so stupid.
Well, here's the whole match. There were 10 girls, whatever. They all entered, and at this point, there had only been one elimination. And it was Selena's, because she's horrible, and they had to get her out of there. So, the last girl enters, they go to commercial, and they come back, and half the crew's gone.
Yeah.
We missed half of the stuff that actually matters.
They left Rocka Khan in there forever. What a disaster that was. That's total amateur hour. And then Christy. I would love to see Christy and Rocka Khan. What a match that would be. And it gets better because it came down to Gail and the Beautiful People. And Gail tossed Angelina. And then Velvet fucking Sky tossed a pin Gail. Rolled her up and pinned her. So, yes, Velvet Sky next week is getting a title shot.
Yay!
This is great news.
That actually is great news.
This
that thing about it was the best part of this entire show.
No, there was there. Here's this was the 5 minutes of greatness in 2 hours of bullshit. First, we had Velvet Sky pinning Gail Kim to win a shot at whoever the champion is next week, the new girl, and then they immediately cut backstage to Booker T's locker room. Booker T is the best thing in TNA by miles, by thousands of miles, by the length of the universe. Booker T is the greatest thing in this company. He should be champion. He should be champion forever. He was backstage in his robe, in his pimped out dressing room. He was looking through what appeared to be a TNA yearbook, which I must get my hands on, and he was looking for a challenger for tonight, and he chose Consequences Creed. He said that he was like Apollo, it reminded him of Apollo Creed and Rocky, who gave the unlikely challenger a shot. And then he suddenly said, "Excuse me," and he called 911 and told them to please. He said, first off, he said, "It's Booker." That's all. They know him. And then he announced that he wanted an ambulance outside the impact zone because a man was going out on a stretcher tonight. This was the best promo I've ever seen.
Promo was great. The catalog or yearbook, whatever that was great. It's Booker was great. Why does Booker T get to pick his opponent in the stipulations?
Because he's the fake champ.
That's just the rule now?
Wait a second. You're mad about that when Christian fucking booked a match next week on free TV? Booker's at least the number one contender, and he has possession of the fucking title.
Apparently he is the champ now.
God, this show. The only good thing about this was just Booker T. He's so great. Such a great man. Then we got a skit with Lethal and Val, which went about 10 seconds, so what's the point?
Val can't blame Sonjay for thinking that she's hot. That was the point.
I hate this show. She's supposed to be the baby face.
Yes.
She's supposed to be like Elizabeth.
Well, Jay,
remember all those times Elizabeth was like, I can't fault Hogan for thinking I'm a babe.
Of course George Steele likes me, Randy.
Look at me. Look at my tits.
I am a hot piece of ass.
Then Sonjay and Eric Young and Johnny Devine in a three-way. Why is this match happening, I asked. Why is this three-way happening? I don't know. They wanted to have a three-way TNA match. They had one. Sonjay beat Eric Young with a chop block.
Yes. Eric Young hit a Death Valley driver on Devine, and he got up, and Sonjay chopped him. Had never worked on the leg before, by the way. It's not like there was an injury story here. No. He just got pinned with a chop block.
Damn. And then they had the big brawl with Lethal coming out, and this was another. This happens. I just hate this. Lethal runs in to beat up Sonjay, so Lethal's running wild, but they cut him off. Sonjay Dutt and the other dork,
Devine,
cut off Lethal, and then Lethal just makes his own comeback and keeps going. Why didn't he just keep making the comeback?
Don't know.
Why did you have to cut him off?
Don't know.
Why do they do this?
I don't know.
Like all those times that Steve Austin did a run-in, but they cut him off first for a while.
Well, that never happened.
And then he made his comeback.
That never happened, Brian.
So stupid. So anyway, after the cutoff that played no part in the story at all, they did the angle where he's about to hit the guru with a chair, but Val stops him for whatever reason. And then as she's going up the ramp, Sonjay grabs the chair, hits the ring post, throws the chair into the hands of Jay Lethal, and then falls down and sells to make it seem like Lethal had hit him with the chair. And, of course, Val's so fucking stupid she believes it. And, of course, she's not going to watch the replay to find out what happened.
Val does not watch Impact, and apparently none of her friends do either.
Why would you ever date a girl that's so goddamn stupid? We're supposed to feel bad for
for Sonjay.
For Jay Lethal?
Or for either one, yeah.
What a dumbass. This is your own fault, geek.
For dating a girl this dumb.
God, nobody is likable in this.
Oh, that's the
not a single person
no
is likable.
No one is ever allowed to be likable in TNA except Booker, who is so likable they cannot keep him down.
But he's supposed to be a heel.
Yes. It's amazing, isn't it? Found me.
I just don't know what's going to happen. Like, a book has got to be written about this place someday, but I'm not doing it. Somebody needs to take it upon themselves to just... And it shouldn't even be about TNA. It's just why this business is dying. Why nobody understands wrestling anymore. And just write about TNA. God, this show. Then it gets better. We had Consequences Creed cutting the most excited promo you've ever seen. He was jumping up and down, and he was all excited. He did a spin-a-rooney, and he's going, woo! And you're like, wow, this guy's really excited to be getting this title shot. A new up-and-coming star right here. This led to the match. The people are going nuts for Consequences Creed. They've seen his promo. He comes out, they're like, yay, Consequences Creed! They're chanting his name. Booker T sells for him a little bit at the beginning. Everybody's going crazy. They may see a big upset here tonight. And then Booker just cut him off and got the heat. And then Creed never got a comeback. Booker just hits him with the axe kick, and that rendered him unconscious. And he threw him on the stretcher, and he won. That was the entire fucking match. I was sitting there watching in the beginning and going, God, Booker's doing a great job with this guy. And then he just fucking killed this guy dead. Dead in a fucking doornail. And then he rolled him over the line. And then, of course, more great TNA action straight out of WWE in 1997. Rolls him backstage, goes to put him in the ambulance. Oh, guess who's in the ambulance? Oh, Samoa Joe!
Actually, you're skipping over stupidity here.
Oh.
Booker rolled him out, and the EMTs actually rolled him out. They rolled Creed over the line, through the back, all the way to the ambulance. Booker started to punch Creed. At which point, here's what the EMTs did. They didn't interfere physically. They didn't say, Jesus Christ, stop that. They walked away and they got in the truck to drive.
Yeah.
They trusted Booker T to load Consequences Creed in the ambulance. So he was going to do it, apparently. He went over the door. Joe jumped out, beat the fuck out of Booker T, threw him in the ambulance, closed the doors, and slapped as they would drive away. So the ambulance drives away. Meanwhile, Consequences Creed is apparently suffering from massive internal bleeding behind him, who actually needs an ambulance, and he is just left to rot.
Too bad.
Sucks to be you.
Too bad.
And here's the big finish. Joe turns around, Sharmell swings a black baseball bat at him.
Uh-oh.
And he grabs him and says, where did you get this? And Sharmell runs away.
She couldn't yell big five?
Yeah, note to Joe. Black baseball bats are common. All sporting goods stores have them. Fred Meyer has them. Walmart has them.
This show.
Do I need to... Yeah, so that was a poor ending. Do I need to point out you actually skipped two segments there near the finish?
Like what? What could I have possibly skipped? Oh, LAX whipping...
Beer Money came out. They wanted to whip fans, so they were looking at fans. They looked at young fans and old fans and skinny fans and short fans.
And by the way, not a single fan was afraid he was getting
whipped. No fan. There were fans...
The fans were challenging them.
Yeah, come on, whip me, you pussy. So this made them look bad. And then they picked the only fan they could find bigger than them.
Yes.
This obvious plant was so huge.
Yes.
These bullies picked on a guy bigger than their own size.
Yes.
They didn't pick a woman or an old man or a child. No.
No.
They picked a fair fight.
Yes.
And then they whipped him. Then it occurred to them, hey, we should get Hector. They whipped the piss out of Hector. LAX finally saved. So they don't watch the show either. It took them a long time to realize their friend was getting beat up.
I just picture guys backstage going, uh-oh, our friend's being beaten up. Let me tie my boots.
Is my music ready?
Lace them all
get
the way
get my music
up.
Ready. Yes.
When Tenay goes enough with Hector Guerrero, I was like, preach on, brother. Nobody gives a shit about Hector Guerrero. Yes. Seriously.
And then finally, there was another segment with Team 3D and Kurt Angle. They were now cool with the tables, a five-tables elimination match, basically telling everyone, it's fake and it's going to come down to two guys. Yeah. There will not be a sweep in this because there are going to be exactly five tables. And, they welcomed Sting to the dark side and said he would be in the corner next week.
Yippee-ki-yay. And Tomko was there, who I thought was not getting along with Kurt, but maybe there was a show I missed, or I just don't even care anymore. This show gets two thumbs down.
Yes.
Once again, I don't know how anybody could possibly watch this program. It,
Defies all explanation.
We went from great pro. It's we went from great programming with the X Cup back to bullshit. Just like right after the Angle Joe show, when it was just the best month and the best pay per view in so long, and then back to bullshit. So here we go again. Another 3 weeks of this crap before the next pay per view. So two thumbs down, everybody.
To the back.
Yeah.
The egotistical eight.
The egotistical ace.
Yeah.
The Deuces Wild Tournament. The shittiest tournament in wrestling history. Super Eric and Eric Young. Vince Russo. Impact.
Everything about TNA. Everything about the opening recap.
Everything about the entire show in general. A reverse cage match with the girls.
Okay.
Fuck you, Vince Russo. Just fuck you.
Okay.
That's a good song.
I have to stop here. Brian, please confirm that I am standing and applauding. That gets a standing ovation. That was phenomenal, drop. I just heard myself hating TNA to Ugly Kid Joe.
Yes.
Awesome. I'm in a great mood now.
Well, wait till we start talking about this show.
That great mood will last 4 seconds.
God, this show's lame. This show is just horrible.
So Impact started. Impact, as we noted, has titles every week because they are great works of literature. Title this week was Now You See Him, Now You Don't. And looking back, I have no idea why.
Sting!
When did we see him?
We didn't! We heard his music, and then we didn't see him. Now you hear him, now you don't.
They couldn't even get that right.
I've mentioned this before. Why would you title a show that's supposed to be live?
Because they
so
knew.
So going in, they knew that there was going to be some sort of Sting wackiness, but we wouldn't actually see him.
We wouldn't see him.
I hate this place. Joe and Nash came out through the ring, or through the people, into the ring. There's a cage there. They're friends again, by the way, for those of you keeping track. No explanation why. But Joe said he wanted a cage match with Booker at the pay-per-view with no referees and no rules. I have no idea how you win. I have no earthly idea how you win this with no referees and no rules. Stop for a second.
Okay.
How do you win a match with no referees and no rules?
I guess you kill him. I don't have an answer for that question.
No, but seriously, think about this. If you can't kill the guy, how do you have a match with no referees and no rules? How would you have a cage match with no referees and no rules?
Well,
because you can't say whoever gets out of the cage wins, because that'd be a rule.
That would be a rule. You can't say you have to pin your opponent to win, because that
is a rule.
Rule.
And if you don't have a referee to determine who wins,
how do you know who won? Well, Brian, I'm going to tell you a sad truth. There's no logic on this show. Nothing makes sense.
It gets better. So Booker came out with his belt and talked about how he. Joe had attacked him in the ambulance last week, and that meant he was scurred. And he said he was a drum major in high school, and therefore they need to add more instruments to the party.
I immediately demand footage of Booker T being a drum major. Now!
I want to know what the other instruments were. A trombone?
Xylophone?
A flute?
That big drum they got?
No. The other accoutrements in this match were tables, ladders, and chairs. In a cage!
Inside a steel cage!
Why do you need a ladder in a cage? Why would you need a ladder in a cage?
Why do you need a table in a cage? If you want to hit something with something steel and heavy, there's a cage there.
Yeah, why would you choose wood instead of metal?
I don't know.
Okay, a ladder match is usually because there's something hanging above the ring.
You need the ladder.
And you scale the ladder to get it.
Right.
You can't jump that high.
Of course not.
You can't, I don't know, fly. You got to climb a ladder. So why would you have a ladder inside a cage?
For no good reason.
If you want to climb out of the cage, climb the goddamn cage. Why would you need to climb a ladder?
I don't know.
Why would you need a chair?
Because it doesn't make sense.
I'm going to hit you with this chair instead of just throwing you into metal. This show is just retarded.
Maybe they can be strapped together, too.
So then Booker made a comment that at first I thought was racially charged when he said, "Be afraid of the dark, Joe."
Like, we are, Booker. We are.
And then Don West immediately said, "This must have something to do with Sting." Why?
I don't know.
Why did that have to have anything to do with Sting?
I don't.
What does "Beware of the Dark" have to do with Sting?
I don't know. This, by the way, everyone, this is the opening segment.
Yeah.
There's a lot to hate already.
They interviewed Christian, AJ, and Rhino about the six-man elimination tables match later. AJ was wondering what was up with Sting and if he was really going to show up with Angle.
Yes, they're...
Let me recap the storyline for everybody. Last week, Kurt Angle said that Sting was going to appear, I guess, in their corner for this six-man match. Is that what he said? Something like that. He basically said he talked to Sting and their friends now. Okay? So now AJ's worried. Now, for this to make sense, we, the audience, would have to believe that there's a possibility that Sting would be in Kurt Angle's corner. TNA attempted to create this by having Sting hit Joe with a bat at the pay-per-view. Never mind the fact that Joe was apparently trying to kill a man, and after Sting asked him to please don't kill the guy, Joe flipped him off, and so Sting beat him up. This is inexplicable to TNA why a man would behave in this manner. To everybody else in the world, it makes total sense. To everybody watching the show, there is not a single reason to believe that Sting might actually join the heels. Not a single reason. Yet the entire show is built around whether or not he's going with the heels.
In a twisted kind of way, I think I get it now. Sting's actions make sense. Therefore, no one in TNA understands them.
May well be.
That is the key. It makes sense, Brian, because it doesn't make sense.
I'm already confused.
Yes.
Consequences, Creed, Johnny Devine, Jimmy Rave, and Eric Young in a match that has there was no point to it. Except to have a bunch of moves on Impact this week.
I would say it was to have four random guys in there, but Lance Rock got involved, so it was to have five guys in there.
Yeah.
A minute in, Lance Rock interfered. Why? To get beat up.
Yeah.
He ran in, he got beat up, he left, the match continued.
So then we had another great TNA moment where Creed won, but then, of course, all the bad guys immediately beat him up. Which begs the question, if you didn't want the guy to get over, why didn't you just have someone else win?
I don't know.
Why did Creed win?
And then get buried.
You win to get over, but then they immediately beat him up.
So
what was the point?
Nothing.
Just have Jimmy Rave win or something. Have somebody else win if you want Jimmy Rave to beat him up afterwards. So then, of course, LAX made the save. And I would like to note that... Oh, no, Abyss. I'm sorry. They made the save for somebody else.
The Stay Puft Marshmallow Man came out.
Abyss made the save. He's a new man. The angle is that he could have beaten up the bad guys with a chair, but he decided not to. He's changed.
Yes, okay. I need to recap this. Five guys had a match. There were bodies flying around. It was impossible to keep track of. A man won. Then there was an angle where he was beaten up. Then there was an angle where he got saved. Then there was an angle where the guy who saved him didn't want a chair. This was the opening match.
Indeed. And they announced that Abyss made saves when men were in, quote, dire need and severe trouble.
Sometimes it's hard to hate Don West. He explained this matter-of-factly.
Yes.
Like it was on the back of a cereal box.
Like there was a instructions list or something. So we had Borash interviewing Angle and Team 3D about the tables
match.
You get
a character sheet for Abyss that says, personality profile, saves men when they are in dire need and severe trouble.
We had the Kaz deal with Karen Angle, which we already recapped in full, so I don't need to go over it again.
They did have awesome music that appeared to be from Who Wants to Be a Millionaire or some such...
It was Unsolved Mysteries.
That may have also been it.
Which, actually, this segment itself is still an unsolved mystery. How did this air on television? How did nobody catch that the term WWE was never mentioned and nobody had any idea what he was talking about, and they thought the guy was burying his own company? Then we had Matt Morgan against Corey Chavis. Let me speak on this.
Totally.
I wrote a book once. Death of WCW. For those of you that have not read it, head over to figure4online.com, the front page. Click on the order tab up on top. And actually, I don't even know if you can order it through Amazon since I think it's sold out. I hope it's sold out and not just out of print. But anyway, point is, I wrote this book. And one of the things that I determined upon writing this book was what a miracle it was that they never screwed up Goldberg. That is a miracle. They screwed up everything. Well, they did screw up Goldberg in the end.
But they got him to a point where screwing him up was that much worse.
They managed to get the guy over as a major league mega superstar before they fucked him up. Okay? That's amazing to me. But the point is, even the most... Actually, I can't even say that. Even a very inept company... Because I don't know if I can even say that WCW is the most inept. Because they at one point had a peak, which TNA has not had yet. But anyway, even WCW figured out how to do Goldberg. TNA can't figure it out. They had Matt Morgan, not against, say, Johnny Devine or Jay Lethal. They had Matt Morgan against Corey Chavis. Corey Chavis actually got offense on Matt Morgan.
Yeah. And it's not, by the way, this is not Corey Chavis from the NFL.
No.
This is
an average
some
man.
Some other guy.
The guy that Matt Morgan was supposed to squash actually got moves in on him. And it took Matt Morgan, like, 2 minutes to beat this guy.
This squash went way too long.
How can you screw this something so simple up?
And you know, speaking of, Brian, screwing things up, it's probably not as bad as screwing the Goldberg push, but you recall that Matt Morgan has two jobs right now.
Oh, yes.
One is as a wrestler for Total Nonstop Action. The other, he plays the role of Beast on the physical game show American Gladiators. Yeah, it's big exposure for TNA, you would think. They have this guy who's... You know, he's part of their show, now he's a star on a show on primetime network television. So when did they plug his debut? Did they do it a month before he showed up in Gladiators? Did he show it a week before he showed up in Gladiators? No. They waited until after his debut to plug the show.
Yeah.
My God!
Yeah. I love how they as Dave noted, they pay all this money to these Survivor jackasses. And then Matt Morgan's on network TV on American Gladiators, and they plug it after the fact. I actually would have recorded it if I would have known it when he was debuting this past Sunday. Yeah. But I didn't know it until today.
No, I didn't know it until right then.
Dumbass.
And by the way, he hit his finisher, which is this wacky suplex into a slam thing. It's called the Hellevator.
Yeah.
And he hit this move, Morgan did, and Don West said, and I quote, Corey Chavis just joined Morgan's Mile High Club.
Fucking in the bathroom.
Hmm.
It's the only thing that can explain it.
All I can say is,
They fucked in the bathroom, apparently, before this match. The latrine. Let's play a song. I can't even imagine Maria in HD.
Now you have 7 days to wait.
In fact, I have 6 days to wait.
Oh, no. Oh, that's, as we speak.
No, it is Tuesday right
what
now.
What a great debate this was. You have 6 days and 20 hours.
Yeah.
I rounded up.
Why? Don't do that. 6 days.
Sorry, master.
Six days left.
Oh, I understand. You can wait 6 days. 6 and 20, that you can't pull off.
No, 7 I can't pull off.
I see.
6 and 20 I'm okay with. That's still 6 days. That ain't 7. It's not 7 though, is it?
It's closer to 7 than 6.
But it's not 7.
Nor is it 6.
Yeah, it is.
No!
Less than 7 is not 7. It's just not.
Nor is it 6 though!
But it's more than 6.
It's
but
part
it's
of
still
6.
6.
What?
Okay, 6.99999 to infinity. Huh? It's still 6. It ain't 7.
How the hell did you ever get out of high school?
But it's not 7.
How do you balance a checkbook?
Well, I'm a genius. And that's why I can tell you right now that anything less than 7 is not, in fact, 7.
No one's denying that, dude.
Okay, well, I'm telling you that there are not 7 days left till I get to see Marine HD.
Fine.
There's
Ryan,
6.
There's, no. As long as...
It's
less than 7 days.
That's true.
Fair.
6. 6 and something. It's 6 and something.
Okay.
Is it not?
It is 6 days and change.
It's that's not fine. Exactly 6. I'm well aware of that.
Okay.
At 9 o'clock tonight, it'll be exactly 6. But
yes.
For right now, it's not 7.
Okay.
Okay, that's all I'm trying to say. That was a pinnacle moment in the history of this show.
What puds we are.
You!
What?
I was right!
We all shut up.
I had mathematicians emailing me afterwards and telling me that you were in fact
don't lie.
I'll forward you the emails. Why would I lie about that?
Because
why would I lie to come off correctly?
Because you're a fragile ego and low self-esteem?
How dare you? Of all the people to be accusing me of that.
I didn't know them because I can spot my own.
We got about the 50th UFC commercial, and it's about 40 minutes into the show, so they're plugging it like crazy. This is, of course, head-to-head with CBS again. Oh, this weekend. Machine Guns did a promo about beer money. This was actually a hilarious promo. You'd never know from watching Impact that these guys are so funny. But we actually got it for the first time here on Impact, so this was good.
The highlight was when they were discussing... They called Robert Roode a pudgy cow, or excuse me, James Storm a pudgy cowboy, and Robert Roode a Wall Street prick, and then Saban stopped and turned to Shelly and said, "Jackie, would ya?" And Shelly was thoughtful, and he gave a very long, articulate response, and Saban nodded and said, "Me too, me too."
In my abode, I suppose I would, but not here
in the comfort
room.
Of my abode, but not here in the locker room. And Saban agreed, "Me too, me too." And let me tell you something, folks, they're funnier than us.
Yeah,
they were third delivery kicked our asses.
We had Super Eric, Curry Man, and the Fish Man having a meeting. These men were not funnier than us.
Ever.
This was ridiculously bad.
This is so...
Not even funny bad.
No.
Just bad.
I must mention this. Curry Man, Lauren asked Curry Man what he was doing. And he replied, I'm not making this up, Roarin', I'm on Rookout. It's 2008. 2008.
What do you want me to do? I didn't write this show.
Jesus Christ.
Gets better. Not only was this stupid, but we had the token insider reference in which the group is called the Prince Justice Brotherhood, and Prince Justice was Abyss's name before TNA for the zero of you that knew that.
I didn't know that. I'm proud I didn't know that.
There's an obscure reference for you. Machine Guns versus Beer Money. This was a strap match for really no good reason on television. And another great way to ensure that they could have had a better match, but they were handicapped by a strap. With that said, there was the best spot I've seen in the history of TNA in this match.
Even better than when Beer Money yelled, beer and then money.
They all got down on the canvas in the star, and they did the row the boat spot on the heels. And Jackie hit the ring, again right in front of the referee, but I can't complain too much because it was so great. She hit the ring, and she fell into the middle of the star, was on her back, and could not escape. She was a turtle.
All right. So, God, the spot was awesome. First of all, just the fact they did the row the boat spot here in this double strap match. They're rowing the boat, and thank God for Robert Roode and the way he sold this row the boat. You've never seen a man sell the row the boat.
That's fantastic.
So awesome. So, Jackie's terrified that her men, their groins are going to be pulled apart. Their wishbones are going to be broken like turkeys. So she jumps into the ring. I don't know what her plan was. You would think she would kick Alex Shelley or strike Chris Sabin. But she ran in the ring, kind of bent over, and then Brian mentioned they were in a star formation. Apparently the star burned out and turned into a black hole. Because she was sucked, she did a flip bump over, ass over tea kettle, as Cornette would say, landed on her back in the middle of the star, and then was trapped there like a turtle, waving her arms and legs in the air until the referee came to rescue her.
Awesome.
So amazing. Just jaw-dropping.
This was just fabulous. A fabulous little spot. And then who won? Doesn't even matter.
Beer Money, I think, for the first time actually won
That's
a match.
That's right, they did. They won their first match.
The match, as Brian noted, it would have been better if they just done a tag team match. It was still fun. It was still a lot of fun. And Beer Money finally won. Then they whipped Machine Gun some more, and then LAX saved. Everything here made sense. This was a fun segment.
And we had Velvet Sky. Afterwards, when Beer Money was whipping him and LAX made the save, I'd like to note that LAX made the save faster for the Machine Guns than they did for Hector Guerrero last week.
Her own guy, yes.
Yeah, that should tell you something. Velvet Sky and Taylor Wilde for the Knockouts title. I was so excited, and then I was so dismayed as Velvet got pinned in 5 seconds with a cradle. They called it a new Impact record. And then Velvet cut a promo demanding a rematch, in which she said, and I quote, "I dare you! What are you, scared?" So Taylor Wilde said, fine.
The Knockouts are 6 years old, yes.
Beat her again with a small package, 25 seconds total. And then Angelina grabbed the mic and said this was bull crap and offered $5,000 for another match. Not with her, mind you, with Velvet. Do not hire this woman to be a business advisor for whatever you're doing.
She's a poor accountant? Poor investor.
Her person lost twice in 25 seconds. So she offered $2,500 or $5,000 for a third match. Bad investment. And worse, she interfered for the DQ. She cost herself $5,000 theoretically here.
Yeah.
Match was actually fine when Velvet was getting the heat, but then Velvet had to
take bumps
for the comeback, and my God, was it horrible. This woman, I love the beautiful people. They're great heels. But if Velvet's going to be featured in matches, she's got to be a babyface. This is not going to work as a heel. Her selling and bumping and feeding as a heel is
wretched.
Just not good. But anyway,
maybe they could just only do tag team matches, since they're a tag team and all.
Afterwards, they beat her up
they put the bag on her head.
Put the bag on her.
This is the best gimmick ever. This is better than Jake Snake. This is better than Brutus Beefcake cutting his opponent's hair. They put a paper bag on her head. And everyone tells it like it's a horrible atrocity.
I know.
That's awesome.
And then, of course, they...
Gail and ODB saved.
Gail and ODB made the save.
There was a long brawl and turkey involved.
We had an Abdul Bashir promo. That's the former Daivari. He is now a classic foreign heel. You know the gimmick.
Even better, he's a rich foreign heel.
Yeah.
He's talking about all the money he made here in America. Then he talked about the nice suit he was wearing, which was several sizes too big. This show is so rinky-dink.
And we had a commercial for the Tank versus Kimbo DVD, which amazed me. Sonjay was in the hospital with the Guruites, and, I don't even know what to say about this, because the big complaint I had last week was, okay, Sonjay is pretending that Jay Lethal hit him with a chair, and Val's so stupid she's not going to watch the replay. This made no sense. So they actually tried to explain it. They were in the hospital. Sonjay was selling a head injury from the fake chair shot. Val was there. And Sonjay was like, Val, you didn't see the replay, did you? And, of course, she said no. That's good. If she would have had an excuse, such as, it didn't record.
My cable went out.
My mom was over and taped Celebrity Justice on it.
I hate the show and can't watch it.
No, her excuse was... You know I hate violence. She's a ring girl.
Or pro wrestling.
Her job... I couldn't tell if this was just them being unfathomably stupid, or if this was supposed to be comical. It was comical.
I love stupid comedy. I'm a huge fan of brain-dead, nonsensical, stupid jokes. This segment left me insulted. I cannot believe they thought I was dumb enough to laugh at this.
Yeah.
The hospital was clearly just a room. Just a corner of the impact zone.
Yeah.
The doctor came in. It all ended with a bedpan joke.
Yeah.
That was the big payoff. Oh, ho!
Do they think they're still writing for Vince?
I guess so.
I don't get it.
Well, that bedpan joke was funny, though.
You've left WWE, everybody. You've left WWE. You do not have to write for Vince McMahon anymore.
There was one other bedpan joke they did in that company, and that one was awesome.
With Steve Austin?
Because it made a loud noise when it struck Vince in the head.
And Vince's selling was so comical.
Vince was scream, pang, silence. That's what made it so golden. But yes.
We had Angle.
That was better than this bedpan joke.
Angle and Team 3D versus Christian, Rhino, and AJ in a 5-tables elimination match.
How many tables, Brian?
5.
5 tables, you say.
Why?
Well, you would think, because there's 6 dudes here, so what they're telling everyone is, this is a fake match, and it's going to come down to the final 2 guys. That's what the name of this match meant to everyone.
Yeah.
And 5-tables elimination match.
Gets better. So, it was Angle and Team 3D against Christian, Rhino, and AJ. Who was the first guy eliminated?
Devon! I was going to say Dudley, whatever his name is
who?
Now.
Who?
Brother Devon.
No, seriously. Who was the first guy eliminated?
The black man, Brother Devon.
You got to be kidding me.
He went through a table. That meant he was out of the match. Now it was 3-on-2 advantage for the babyfaces.
Well, that's awfully stupid.
The babyfaces had the heat, Brian.
You got to be kidding me.
No, this happened.
What idiots.
You know what they did when they had the heat? They got weapons.
Yeah.
They picked up weapons and started to beat their helpless, outnumbered foes.
And then the second elimination took place during the break. The show is taped in advance and edited together, and they couldn't even make sure that there wasn't a break when this man was eliminated.
Okay, by the way, Dio went through a table. That's one.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then...
Rhino went through a table during the break.
That's two.
That's two!
And then we had Devon putting Christian through a table, so he interfered.
Stop right there. Devon interfered behind the ref's back.
Yeah.
What was the ref going to do? Disqualify his these men?
I don't know.
Was he going to throw the match out?
Maybe manually break a table so they'd be at a disadvantage?
I guess so.
I don't know how it works.
So Christian went through a table. That's three!
That's three. So
it was AJ versus Kurt and Brother Ray.
That's right. And then Johnny Devine got involved in front of the referee, as I noted, who didn't care. And he got put through a table.
Huh. Well, that's four, right?
I guess so.
I write that down. Hang on. I'm confused myself now. Devine went through a table. That's four!
That's four. So then Bubba got sent through a table, and there's your five.
That's five. Oh, shit, they're out of tables. What do they do now?
Well, luckily they had another table.
Just a six table. Which begs the question, why did you call it a five-table elimination match? What was the point of that?
To annoy me.
That annoyed me more than anything else in the show.
Really?
The fact that they had this stupid name for the match that let everyone know it was fake, was going to come down to the final two guys, and then they just had a six table anyway.
I'm glad how everybody can find something different to hate about this program.
Remarkable. So diverse in its things to loathe.
And then AJ put him on a table and went up top, but Frank Trigg interfered after the ref bump, of course, and then hit AJ with a stick. And again, what would the referee have done if he would have seen Frank Trigg hit the man with the stick? Was he really going to call for a DQ? What was he going to do? Was he going to say, okay, I caught you, angle, get on the table, AJ jump through him. Come on, you guys, you cheaters. So anyway,
this show sucks.
AJ won, so of course AJ losing at the pay-per-view didn't mean a goddamn thing because he got his win back here for free on TV, and no sting. That led to the final segment.
Sting did not show up, and no one mentioned this. The announcers didn't, nor did Bubba, nor did Diva, nor did Kurt.
I noticed it amazingly. I don't know why I paid so much attention to this show. I shouldn't have. Booker and Joe came out for the contract signing. Booker explained TLC in a cage. Then he told Nash to hit the bricks. And Joe said, well, Nash will bail if your wife bails. And Booker's like, what, are you scared of my wife? And fans began to actually chant, you're scared.
Morons.
And I was like, wow.
Morons.
There's your fucking babyface world champion. Crying pussy.
The guy who
scared of a girl.
Came through his people at the opening of the show.
Yeah.
So, yes. So Booker dismissed Sharmell, but not before giving her a passionate kiss, the woman he loves. Then he turned to Joe with a smirk and said, you can do that if you want, implying that he and Nash are butt buddies.
Sure.
And Joe said, I'd love to, but I've heard Sharmell's not a good kisser. And Joe and Nash had a hearty laugh. Mike Tenay and Don West spent about a minute falling over themselves talking about how cool Samoa Joe was here.
And how how his joke was much funnier. They had to tell us this.
They had to explain, Joe is good. Joe is cool. Like Joe.
And they wouldn't have to do this if he wasn't booked like such an idiot.
You would think.
So then the lights went out. Oh, wait. Booker signed and then gave the contract to Joe. And then the lights went out. Sting's music played for about 5 seconds. The lights turned back on. Joe was laid out. Booker was standing there with a bat. And the announcers began freaking out about what Sting had done.
Yes, that happened. That happened exactly like you said. So, we are to think...
Booker signed the contract, and he gave it to Sting.
To Joe.
Joe. The lights went out. Sting's music played for 5 seconds. The lights came back on. Joe was laid out. Booker T had a bat. And the announcers blamed it on Sting.
Immediately. There was no doubt in their minds that what had happened during these 5 seconds, which, by the way, I think is charitable. I think it was shorter than that.
Could have been.
In this very short passage of time, Sting had come down to the ring, hit Joe with a bat, handed the bat to Booker T, pointed it so it was pointing at Joe's lifeless body, and then hustled off back to the back. He's the Flash. He has magical powers now.
Booker was wearing a giant robe.
Suitable for hiding things like bats.
He could have hid a baseball team in that robe. Yet the announcers were sure that Sting was responsible for this. This storyline is so unbelievably dumb. Because not a single solitary viewer...
No one could possibly think Sting did this.
Not a single viewer. So I guess in the end it must be a swerve and Sting's going to go heel for his final run in TNA. That can't possibly happen. They cannot be that dumb. I don't know. This show, everybody, thumbs down. Oh, can I just end there, everybody? Thumbs down.
Nothing was surprising to Sting.
You know what I think about this show? Thumbs down.
He could stay a babyface. He could turn heel. And by the way, when they were asking what's Sting going to do, AJ talked about how everyone was talking about how Sting would turn. That was his exact word. Sting's going to turn.
Yeah.
So, yes.
It's fake, everybody.
Sting could be a babyface. Sting could stay heel. Sting could turn inside out. Nothing would surprise me.
Maybe just do a turn on tiptoe. I don't know.
Do a pirouette. This show sucks. Bad. If you're watching it, stop.
Bad show, everybody.
Stop watching right now.
Bad show. Other than that, everything was great.
Besides that, everything.